that is because all the tutorials out today. So, without further breaks and everything, we'll start with the first tutorial, and hopefully we'll be able to implement the Google of 3D objects afterwards.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. My name is Ivan Cipiran. I am a postdoc researcher in the University of Konstanz in Germany. And today, along with Professor Tobias Schreck from the Graz University of Technology, we are presenting a tutorial about 3D shape retrieval, or 3D three-dimensional shape retrieval in MACG. The main idea of this tutorial is to present a summarization of this field. This research field is about 20 or 15 years ago, maybe, and this field has evolved in the time. You know, maybe the first in the first time when this field appears, all the techniques were very basic, trying to solve the problem of how to measure the similarity between three-dimensional models, and now we have more efficient and more effective techniques. And the idea of this tutorial is to present this pipeline of this evolution of this field, and to present some basic techniques and then some new applications also. We have been working in new applications, so also the idea of this tutorial is to present what is the new trends in this field, and also how to maybe improve these algorithms in order to maybe motivate the investigation and the improvement of all these algorithms for the community. Okay, this is the outline of the tutorial. Basically, we want to introduce to you to the field, for example, showing the examples, showing what is the problem. Okay, so this outline is about how to, what is the main concept of the field. For example, what do we mean when we are talking about three-dimensional similarity? And also, we want to show you some applications that we have in this field in the past. And then we will introduce some techniques. The idea is to not to be so comprehensive in the literature, but just to show some main techniques and main approaches that have been conducted in this field. And we will show three kind of problems inside the three-dimensional shape retrieval. The first one is the generic shape retrieval, the second one the partial shape retrieval, and the sketch-based shape retrieval. We will go into this, and I will show some details later. And then we have a very exciting way of how to promote the field and also the data sets and the algorithms, and it's called the shape retrieval contests. These contests are competitions in which every people that has propose a technique, they can evaluate algorithms using the standard benchmarks. And this is a very good initiative because obviously you can compare your algorithms with previous state-of-the-art methods, and you can see if your method is better or not, for example, with respect to the state-of-the-art. Okay, and we will show some examples of these retrieval benchmarks and some references to how to do this. And then we will show almost at the end of the presentation novel applications of three-dimensional shape retrieval, applications that are in the development in the current time. And then we will show some final remarks at the end. Okay, so basically just a summarization of these parts in the introduction to the field. We would like to show you why the 3D shape retrieval is important now. And this is because we have a lot of three-dimensional data. And this data is now growing and growing and growing. So this is a very realistic problem. And then also how to think about the problem of three-dimensional shape retrieval. Basically, this is the main question. Okay, if I have two three-dimensional models, how can I compare it using only the geometric information? Okay, with respect to applications, we can have, for example, applications in CAD, applications in biotechnology, applications in medicine, applications in entertainment, and the applications are being developed currently. Then we will show some basic approaches, for example, the bag of features approach, for example, the feature vector approach, and also approaches for sketch pair retrieval that combines somehow image information with three-dimensional models. Then we will show the shape retrieval contest and also some new applications. For example, this application in which we are working actually, that is application of three-dimensional shape retrieval in archaeology, or how to use the information of the shapes in order to complete or restore archaeological objects, for example. And also applications in the domain of visualization. Okay, so let me start with the introduction to the field. If we think about retrieval or search in general, maybe our first idea is to think about Google, right? And the way in which Google works defines many of the concepts that we are also using in this field. The idea is very simple. We have a query, for example, a text query in Google, okay, and we want to search in a large repository of text or web pages something similar to this query, something that may be related to this query. Okay, when we are talking about text, we can do that maybe for doing comparison of text. But the problem comes when we have another kind of information, for example, images. Okay, have you seen that Google now has the image retrieval or the image search engine? Now you have in Google, for example, in Google Image, you have the text box and you can do some query in this text box, but also you can upload an image and Google searches what images are similar to this one using only the information of the image. When we are talking about information of the image, we are talking about appearance, we are talking about the pixels, we are talking about not textual information. Is information that is not in the form of text. So basically it's not organized information. So for three-dimensional shapes, we have exactly the same idea. We want to provide a three-dimensional model as query. We have a large repository of three-dimensional models, and then we want to search which models of this repository are similar to the query object. So basically, if we have, for example, a query object, a three-dimensional model, like this lamp, okay, we have a set of three-dimensional models, maybe coming from, I don't know, different applications, CAD, or modeling, or scanning devices, okay? So we have a large repository. Let's say this is a huge repository of shapes. And then the idea is that I want to search in this repository which models are similar to this one. For example, this. Okay? And maybe the other ones are not similar, so I don't want these models in the retrieval result. So basically the output of this process should be a set of three-dimensional models that are similar to the query. Okay? Now, the problem is how we define formally the concept of similarity. Because obviously, we can see this shape, and we can see that maybe there are some shapes that has similar geometry, but some of them not. For example, this shape is also a lamp, but the geometric information of this shape differs a lot with respect to the query. So basically, the concept of similarity, or the idea of similarity, the model of similarity that we provide to the system will be one that makes us possible to compute this set place. It depends on how we define this similarity model. And this is one of the main problems, right? Because obviously it's almost impossible to think about one similarity model to solve all the problem. Okay, so let me show you three dimensions of the problem of three-dimensional shape retrieval. These dimensions relates to the collections and basically what is the data that we have available for this problem. Devices, because now it's possible to have cheap devices to scan objects or to get objects easily. And also the applications. And basically these three dimensions of the problem give us an idea about how to deal with the problem, how to deal with large collection, how to deal with new data that we can have in applications, and also what are the applications that we can solve with the three-dimensional shape retrieval. Okay, so the first idea is that three-dimensional data now is everywhere. And this is because we have new ways of getting three-dimensional data, not only from the regular channels, for example, modeling, but also from different other sources. For example, now we can have, or we have, three-dimensional collections. Collections of three-dimensional models. This is the Google 3D Warehouse, for example, that contains a lot of three-dimensional models coming from different applications or coming from different sources. CAD, architectural, medicine, and others. And this collection is now about millions of objects, millions of objects. Okay. So maybe 5 years in the future or 10 years in the future, we will need a search engine for this large set of shapes, just in the same way that now we have the image retrieval in Google, for example. Then there is another collection of three-dimensional models. This is the TurboSquid. This is a proprietary collection of three-dimensional models. But also, it applies to the problem because they have, for example, very high resolution and very nice models from modelers that is maybe in the order of 10 million or something like that of three-dimensional models. Yeah, maybe the problem is that these models, they are not free. You have to buy them. But also, they have a large collection, so maybe in the future they will require to have a search engine, because obviously it would be impossible to manage this amount of information. We have also some other repositories, for example, the ShapeNet from Stanford. And they now, this is a very nice example because they are working on three-dimensional similarity of objects, but also they are organizing this large collection using semantic information. And this is interesting because you can get this data set and you can do some experiments using either the information, the geometric information, or either the textual information or the semantic information, for example. And also it contains something like half a million objects so far. But for now, this is only for research purposes. And then there's another collection of the project aim at SHAPE that contains a lot of three-dimensional models, mainly coming from the archaeological applications and also from terrain applications or geological applications. So basically we have a lot of data. And maybe now the data is not the problem. We have data to do experiments, we have data to motivate the problem of three-dimensional shape retrieval. But also, there is another way in which the three-dimensional information is coming and is getting new interest. This is basically the cheap three-dimensional scan devices. For example, with Kinect now, we are obtaining three-dimensional sense everywhere. Okay, and also this data is being stored in data sets or data sets of sense, data set of objects. So basically, with this, we can obtain every object or every scene in the reality. And also another interesting kind of devices or to get three-dimensional data are the specialized scanners. For example, scanners for three-dimensional object, three-dimensional face retrieval, or three-dimensional face scanning. Okay, and we can have a lot of different devices that now are working on real applications. For example, for archaeology or CAD. Okay, and For applications, we can have different kind of applications. For example, here we can decide to do some applications in CAD, because obviously in CAD you have a lot of already available objects, and then maybe you want to use one of these objects to improve your design. So basically you want maybe to retrieve some similar object and then try to use this object or reuse this object to accelerate the process of engineering. Also with MRI, in which we can obtain biometric information from patients, and then we can use this information, as we will see in one of the applications, in which this information is valuable. And also we can decide, or we can do some diagnosis or help to the doctors to do some diagnosis using only the geometric information that we are getting from these devices. And also from the extracted from motion. Extracted from motion means that we can get three-dimensional sense using only the information of millions of images, for example. And then these large point clouds or large objects, maybe, for example, we can help the reconstruction of this sense using retrieval and using similarity. Okay, these are only one set, small set of applications. Okay, so about the similarity models, I showed before that the retrieval problem depends on the similarity model that we choose. And we have, maybe this is just a summarization of what we can do now, but we have four similarity models until now. The first one is the global similarity model, the partial similarity model, sketch-based similarity model, and the non-rigid similarity model. And this is mainly in this concept. The global similarity model means that I want to say that two objects are similar if they have a very similar global shape. Okay, global shape, I mean, for example, these two cars are seemingly very similar because, for example, they have the four wheels, they have, I don't know, maybe the front part is very similar. Okay. So basically, we want to decide if these two objects are similar or not just using the global information of the shape. Okay, for example, interested in just measuring the similarity of the bottom part of the object, or only the front part of the object. No, we want to measure the complete similarity of the object. Okay. Then we have the partial similarity model. The partial similarity model means that, okay, sometimes we don't have the complete models, obviously because, I don't know, maybe this is a part of some three-dimensional design, okay, and I have a complete object. So basically now the idea is how to measure the similarity between this complete model and this part. And this model is different because obviously I don't want to compare this model completely with respect to this. I want to search which part of this object is similar to this one. Okay, it's very, very different to this one because here I am not breaking the object, but here the problem is very, very different, obviously. And then we have another similarity model, and the similarity model of sketch-based retrieval is different because now we don't have two 3D models. Now we have a 3D model and we have a sketch. And this sketch is a two-dimensional representation of one object. And then the question is how to compare these two objects, because this is three-dimensional information, this is two-dimensional information, and this is obviously the problem, how to find a good representation for doing this. And the non-rigid shape similarity model concerns about if I have two objects and these two objects has non-rigid transformation. Non-rigid transformation means that, for example, the elastic transformations of the human or elastic transformation of some given objects. Okay, so basically this is exactly the same object but in a different pose. And this problem is also difficult, and it's a very specialized similarity model that works with some spectral models, for example, or models that only uses the elastic information of the shapes, which is also very different to the other ones. Okay, so we have these four similarity models, and all the techniques and research that have been conducted so far somehow tries to fit in one of these in these models. And then, for example, for the global, we have algorithms to do exactly this, to measure the global appearance. We have some algorithms to do the partial shape retrieval. We have algorithms to do the sketch-based retrieval, and also there are specialized algorithms to do the non-rigid shape retrieval. In our tutorial today, we will show some techniques on the global, partial, and sketch-based retrieval. And we left the non-rigid because obviously this is a very specialized, and also it contains a lot of some background concepts that are maybe not so easy to do in maybe this short time. Okay, so let's see some applications. Now I will show you some applications that uses the concept of similarity and also the retrieval for doing something in the reality. For example, this application about craniofacial research. This study was conducted in the Seattle Children's Hospital Craniofacial Center, and the main idea of the research was to get the three-dimensional model of children's head, okay? And they looked for, investigate what was the dysmorphology of these craniums in order to look for some disorders. And they found that, for example, it was possible to characterize the diseases of children using the geometric information that they have from the head. And they have a lot of these morphologies. They characterize using the geometric information, and then they use this information, for example, local features and histograms. They characterize all this geometric information, and they use this information because now, as they have this wrong fruit, when a new model comes, they were able to see if this new model contains some kind of dysmorphology using only similarity, because they had all this information. And then this information helped to the doctors to do some deep analysis in children that had these problems. This is another application for doing retrieval of proteins models. Okay, so for example, these are models that were obtained with specialized software, okay, that contains the connection between the components, the chemical components. And then they had a large collection of three-dimensional models with same or different proteins. And then the idea was to show if given a new model, a new combination of these products, of these chemical products, maybe there were some similar result in some known model or characteristics. Okay. And this was because when they tried to do some chemical compositions, they wanted to see if maybe this model was not already available from this characterization, and also to see if maybe that the components are useful or not. This is another example in which the three-dimensional retrieval was used for the Mosin's navigation. And basically, in these applications, you can have, for example, only a few examples of three-dimensional models for one museum. But when you are trying to do some navigation, or you are trying to do some virtual reality application or virtual reality process, you can get new models in order to compose the three-dimensional museum real time. Okay. And for this application, for example, they use a very simple descriptor, which is the shape distribution descriptor, and they showed that it was possible to get new models very similar to one of these models in order to apply or to do some variety to the navigation, and that was also one of the main applications. Okay, also for CAD, obviously, because in CAD you can have a very large set of three-dimensional designed models, and then maybe you are proposing or you are doing a new design, and then you want to see if maybe you have already some designed objects, and you can select these models, and also you can see maybe these models can be useful for the application that you are trying to do, for example. And also, this is interesting because you can reuse some of these models according to the designs, because maybe you want to see if you don't need to manufacture the object from scratch, for example. Yeah, maybe you can reuse some pieces that you already have. This is another application in archaeology in which the matching or the similarity model, the similarity concept of geometry has been applied in order to, when we have a three-dimensional scanning parts of this object, okay, these are the real objects, the real pieces of this object. We scan the object and then we can reconstruct the object using the similarity or the complementary geometry of these pieces in order to put them together in the real object, for example. Okay, and this is a very nice application also because it's very useful for the archaeologists. Sometimes it's not possible to do this manually, or you can do it, but you can take a lot of time. But the computer can do it in maybe less time, and you can see that you can get very good results if you define a very good similarity model for this problem, for example. Okay, and this is one of the last applications that we wanted to show you. This is the three-dimensional face recognition. This problem is about when you are trying to recognize people from photographs, for example, if you have high variations of the face, for example, when the people is smiling, or when people is angry, or when people is, I don't know, maybe doing some gesture, okay, in images, it's very difficult to find a good similarity between the stored face of a person and a transformed version of this person. So basically, with this application, the authors provided an algorithm in which they scanned the three-dimensional face, so they get a three-dimensional representation of the face, and then even if you do some gesture in these faces, they found the way to obtain a good intermediate representation in which no matter which kind of gesture you are doing, you obtain exactly the same intermediate representation. And then the similarity model is very simple, because in this representation, I can do, for example, a global matching similarity model or a global retriever, and I can see that this person is the same as this one, this one, this one. Okay? So this variation in the geometry of the faces can be factor out if we, for example, use this technique. And this is one of the application in the three-dimensional retrieval or matching field that is currently in very good development. And we have a very good algorithms for doing three-dimensional face recognition. Okay, so now let me show some basic techniques to do to try to solve the problem of three-dimensional shape retrieval. And basically we will begin with the generic shape retrieval. The generic shape retrieval is the general problem in which we are trying to search for global similarity objects. So basically the global approach means that we want to transform the three-dimensional object, because this object is a triangular mesh, for example, into some numerical representation. So the idea is, given an object, I transform this object into a set of numbers, and then I can compare these numbers into the different objects, and I can measure the similarity. Okay? So this is the main pipeline. I have a three-dimensional model. Maybe we need to do some pre-processing, for example, doing some post-normalization. Then we have to obtain the abstraction of the object, because maybe, I don't know, probably it's more useful to use the volumetric information of the object, the surface of the object, or maybe some projection of the object. So basically we need to decide this. And then after we have this this abstraction, we can obtain, for example, some information. Applying discrete transformation, applying sampling, applying wavelet transformation, Fourier transformation. So we can have a lot of things that we can do with this representation. And then finally, we can compose all these numbers or all these coefficients in order to produce a feature vector, a histogram, or maybe a graph. And then we can do the comparisons of these objects using these representations. So basically, this is one of the main approach that have been used in the field. We have a two-dimensional model. We convert this two-dimensional model into a high-dimensional feature vector. And then this high-dimensional feature vector can be inserted in a high-dimensional index structure. So basically, this is what we can do. And after this composition, in which we have a very large index, we can do the search using only the index, just similar to the Google approach, for example. But the main problem here is, obviously, how to convert this object into a meaningful high-dimensional representation. And we have many approaches. And one of the main approaches that has been applied, and it's the most important approach, and also one of the most effective approach until now, is the depth buffer descriptor. This depth buffer descriptor is a descriptor that is an algorithm that tries to convert an object into a feature vector. And the idea is very simple. We have a two-dimensional object, and this two-dimensional object can be transformed into a set of images. A set of images means that I can get some two-dimensional representation of this object. And basically, when we can have this representation, we can apply image analysis tools for transforming this into, I don't know, maybe coefficients or feature vectors. The problem of this descriptor is that the pose of this object makes the method very dependent on what kind of views we are obtaining, right? Because if I change the pose of the object, I can get different projections or different two-dimensional images. So basically, this kind of methods requires a pose normalization. And the pose normalization means that we can have objects from the dataset, for example, in different rotations, in different sizes, in different positions in the three-dimensional world. So basically, I want to take all these objects into a common framework, a common three-dimensional framework and sizes. So that's the idea of normalization. So in other words, this is the normalization that we can do. For example, we have this three-dimensional model, and we have computed this origin is the three-dimensional origin, the origin of the three-dimensional world. Okay, so basically you can see that the object is moved some way, okay? And also the object is not good normalized in rotation. So basically one of the first step is the translation normalization, which means that we need to move the object to the center of the origin of the three-dimensional world. Okay, so you can see the difference because the origin was here, and also now the origin is here. Okay, and then this object is not in the right position, is not in the right rotation. So basically, the second step is to do the normalization in the rotation, because we want to normalize the position of the object, the rotation. And to do this, we can do the PCA analysis, okay? Because this is no more than a point cloud, for example. And then we can do the PCA analysis in order to distribute all these points around the three-dimensional axis. Okay, and then we can do the transformation. And the final part is that maybe this object, when you apply the PCA, you are not getting the direction of the new framework. You are only obtaining the vector, okay? And the vector can be flipped. And also, we need to do some analysis about the flip of this object in order to get the final good position of this object. Okay, and we can do this one, evaluating the object, the mass of the object. So this is one of the examples in which the pose normalization is applied. You can see that we can obtain good results here, for example. This is very different objects from the same class, Okay, so this is for the cards, for example, we can obtain very good results, and also for the persons. But the problem here with the cups is that the geometric information of the cups in this case are playing a very important role when we are trying to get the good normalization transformation. And this is because, for example, we are trying to get the rotation in order of getting the spread of the objects, the spread of the three-dimensional points in the x-y plane. And this is because this cup, for example, is too short. So when the cup is too short, the main directions of the object is in this way and not in this way. So if you see, for example, if we have a very large variation of objects in the same class, this method is not working. So in the case of the cars, they are all very similar and very structured. So that's why we can obtain this very good representation. So basically, it's not a perfect technique, but we can factor out the problem of the transformation. Okay, so after this post-normalization, the descriptor can be computed. The first idea is to take, when we have this object normalized, I can enclose the object into a cube, and then I can get 6 projections from every face of this cube. So basically, we can have these 6 projections of the object, you know, front, rear, the 2 laterals, part, and top, and bottom. And for each pixel, we store this, for example, the depth information. And then, when we have images, we can apply some numeric transformation, for example, Fourier, and then we obtain the spectral decomposition here, and then we can took a set of these coefficients to represent every view of this object. Okay, and when we have this representation, because we only select, for example, the low frequency coefficients here, we can compare two objects using only these coefficients. Basically, we can do the Minkowski distance or something like that in order to do the similarity. Okay, this is another descriptor, which is somehow similar to the previous one, but in this case, instead of using the orthogonal projections, we can do cylindrical projections. And this cylindrical projections means that instead of enclosing the object into a cube, we enclose the object into a cylinder. And then after doing this, we do the projection in the lateral face of the cylinder, and we can get this different representation of the object. And we can do exactly the same procedure that the previous technique. Okay, basically, we can compute the Fourier transformation, we can compute the wavelet transformation, and then we can compare the coefficients of this transformation in order to do the similarity of objects. Okay, this is another example of technique that uses basically the same concept. We can do the projections of the object, okay, and then after this projection, we can select only the contour of this object. Okay, and then these contours can be sampled. For example, we can sample some equidistant points in this sampling, and then we can measure the distances in a polar system, for example, and then we can do also this because this is a signal, and we can do a Fourier transformation or something like that, okay, to get a final representation of the vector. Okay, so basically we can play with many of these representations, and we can get different numeric representation for objects. This is a different approach. This approach is about the three-dimensional harmonics, and this uses the voxelization of objects. And in this case, this polygonal model is transformed to a volumetric representation. And then this volumetric representation can be decomposed in a set of spherical functions. And this spherical function means that we can enclose this object in different spheres from different sizes, and we can get spheres with different values depending on the size. And then this is a spherical function, and we can apply the spherical Fourier transformation, and we can decompose all these functions into a set of spherical coefficients, and it's exactly the same like the Fourier transformation in the plane, okay, which we can have these coefficients in a histogram, for example, and then we can combine them in a matrix. And then we can compare all these objects using this signature. Okay. Also, we can have some structural descriptors. Structural descriptors mean that we don't want to use the geometric information, or not directly the geometric information, but for example, we can obtain a skeletal representation of the objects doing some kind of skeletonization, for example. And then we can compare the objects using this representation. Basically, it's a graph, a geometric graph. Okay, so we can compare these two objects, maybe not from the geometrical point of view, but maybe from the structural point of view. So we can see that this object has the same structure as this one, and this can be our similarity model. Okay, there are many other approaches, and if you are interested to see more approaches, you can go to the Shrek 2009 Generic Shape Retrieval. This is from the contest that I mentioned before. And for example, in this special track of the contest, we had a competition with more than 20 algorithms, and you can get there the numbers of the results, and you can get also other approaches that can be applied for this problem. And this is interesting because this is a database of results, and then we can obviously compare our algorithms using these results. Okay, there are also some other resources to get more insight about this problem. For example, there are many surveys on three-dimensional shape retrieval. These are the three main references that we have. And basically here you can get a very good insight, and also this is a very good resource to start to search new techniques. And then also recently we had the large scale evaluation algorithms that contains a very large scale data set to do the evaluation of the generic shape retrieval. It was proposed in 2014. Okay, so now we will see some basic things about the partial similarity search. And the partial similarity is something that is different. One of the first cases, for example, we have this centaur and we have a horse. And the question is, how can we compare this centaur to this horse and to see if there are some parts that are similar? Okay, the idea here is that there is a part in the centaur that is similar to a part in the horse. Okay? So basically these are objects with similar parts, but the size of these parts are not known. Okay? And this is another problem. Another problem is when we have a complete object and I have a view of this object, for example, obtained by a scan. When I scan an object, I can get this. This is not a complete object. This is just a view of the object. So basically, this is another problem because I want to search this view into this object and to see if this fits this object. Okay, so these are two different views of the problem of partial similarity search. Maybe we can use the same technique to solve both, but for example, in this case, there are techniques that are specialized for this kind of problem and specialized for this kind of problem. Okay, so one of the main thing that maybe we learned from this problem is that the only thing that we can deal with this problem is using local information, because obviously we cannot get a global representation that makes similar these two objects. So basically the local information is one of the things that we need to use. And the approaches that have been proposed for this problem are in this direction, basically the local approach. The local approach means that, for example, we can use the back-of-future approach. The back-of-future approach is a very known approach in text and image retrieval that tries to decompose an object or an entity into a set of local pieces of information. And then these local pieces of information needs to be integrated in order to represent parts or represent some local behaviors of the objects. In general words, if we have a set of three-dimensional objects, for example, the idea is to get a set of local characterizations. For example, I can get a point on the surface and I can produce a feature vector for every point in the object. So here we can have, for example, 5,000 descriptors, 5,000 descriptors, and more. And then this is a large collection of high-dimensional descriptors. And this collection of high-dimensional descriptors saves some commonalities. And the idea is to find these commonalities, because these commonalities means, obviously, the similarity between the local information. So we mixed all these descriptors into a large set of characterizations of descriptors, and then we can apply a simple clustering. And this clustering will find the commonalities of the local information between different shapes. And then we can do the quantization, and this quantization corresponds to the local information or groups of local information that we can have here. So basically, we need to compute local descriptors, then we need to do a high dimensional clustering, and then we can do the quantization, and then we can compare these histograms. And this histogram contains aggregated local information. So that's why we can compare this and to show that maybe it can get some good results for partial retrieval. So this is the idea, that the distribution of local descriptors in the feature space can reveal local structures. And these local structures means that we can get some partial similarity. This is another approach. It's the same concept, the same idea about Babel features, but in this case, we use diffusion descriptors, which is a very nice and very current effective descriptor to shapes. Okay, and basically the Babel feature approach has been proved to be very effective for this problem. Okay, so the idea is the same. We have models, we sample some points in the models, we describe these models, we find the feature vectors for these models, we apply the clustering, and we look for the visual dictionary, and then we do the quantization until we get some histogram to represent the object. And then these are some of the results that we can get. And you see that here, for example, these are very artificial models in which we have a person with an octopus head, okay, and we can get, for example, persons in the first places of the ranking, and then we can get other different shapes. And basically, this is because we are dealing somehow with the problem of partial similarity. This is another example, the shape Google technique. Okay, it has the shape Google name, but maybe it's not so much a Google. Okay, it's just a marketing name for the technique. Okay, and basically the idea is the same. You have a set of shapes, and then you can compute local descriptors in the shape, and then you can apply the Babel features approach. But in this technique, the main ingredient is that they compose a matrix of spatially sensitive Babel features. The problem is that when you apply the clustering, you are losing the spatial information. But in this case, they looked for a way in which you can get the geometric information back to the representation. And then this is more effective than only using the Babel feature, the regular Babel feature. And one of the main things is that, for example, for the partial, this is a data set. They apply this into a large scale data set for retrieval. And for the partial transformation, that basically is the problem of partial similarity, they obtain a very high values of effectiveness for the retrieval. And the numbers here means the degree of partiality. It means that the number 5 is when you have less information than in this part. So basically, this number is very good. Depends on obviously how difficult is the data set, but in this case, this is one of the best results in the state of the art for partial similarity in large scale scenarios. And this is another technique in which they authors segment the shape, and then they describe each segment. Okay, and then after the description of each segment, they apply the Babel features again, and then they can compose a final multi-level Babel features, and you can compare the objects also. Okay, and this is a very recent approach for dealing with the problem of views. Okay, when you have only views. And they used specialized algorithms to get the local descriptions, in this case, the description of point, using only the locality of the point. And that's why, because they, for example, can get this result. They have this query. This is a part of an object. And they have this query, and they can obtain these similar objects. Okay, and the same for these potteries. And this is interesting because, for example, you can use this result because maybe you can infer that this part of this object corresponds to this similar object. And this is interesting for archaeological applications, for example. Okay? These are some evaluations also and resources. There is a survey recently published in 2014 about the partial 3D object retrieval methodologies. And also we have the benchmark for the similarity between scan images and three-dimensional models that we proposed along with Professor Tobias Schreck in 2014. And also we have, for example, now data sets for doing retrieval of scanned data from the using the three-dimensional scanner. Okay, we get a view and then you apply the three-dimensional shape retrieval. And this is a more recent data set for doing this. Okay, so I think I will finish this part and I will get to Professor Tobias Schreck to continue the presentation.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ivan, for this first part of the tutorial. Now it's a pleasure to continue here. As introduced, my name is Tobias Schreck. I've been working for the last 2 years at the University of Konstanz in further developing research approaches for tackling the shape similarity problem. And yeah, now I want to continue with a brief introduction to the third similarity model that Ivan has introduced, which is the sketch-based similarity search. And here, the problem is not to compare existing 3D models that may be given in, for example, point clouds or polygon mesh representations, but here the problem is to compare. Here the problem is to compare a user sketch with an existing modeled 3D object. The use case for this is that not always a user who is interested in finding a given object may have an example may not always have an example to submit to the query engine, but just the user sketch may be a quick and convenient way to outline what is needed. And then submit this user sketch to the search engine that will then basically with the mechanism that Ivan has already explained, namely extraction of features and then comparison of features between the user sketch and the object, compute a similarity function, a similarity score that will then be able to rank the objects. Yeah, what are the main problems here? So obviously a problem is that we are having to deal with different object representations. We have, on the one hand side, 3D objects, modeled, obviously, or often in high detail, with polygon or other representations. And on the other hand, we have user sketches, which can vary quite a lot in their style with respect to level of detail that is sketched, and also with respect to the perspective. So some people sketch perspective representations, other people may sketch orthogonal outline representations, yet other users may sketch skeletal representation. And the question is how to map these possibly different representations to the 3D shape and come up with a similarity score in the end. So one idea that has been picked up in the research community here to tackle this problem is to basically convert the three-dimensional object into a representation that is more close to how a user sketch could look like or would look like. To that end, one can resort to techniques from non-photorealistic rendering and, for example, the suggestive contour technique that has been proposed in 2003 by De Carlo and colleagues. Provides a mechanism that will generate renderings that look more similar to a sketch than to a photorealistic rendering, of course. So basically the idea is to identify contours that can characterize the three-dimensional shape, and as part of pre-processing, we convert every three-dimensional object from the database into a contour representation that can then be more easily compared with the user sketch. So this is actually what is done during pre-processing in order to convert the three-dimensional object to a representation more closer to the user sketch. Then the question arises, how do we index these user sketches as well as the non-photorealistic renderings that we obtained? And one proposal here is to resort to an approach that has been shown quite successful in object recognition and more general computer vision applications, which is the so-called histogram of oriented gradients. Here the idea for this descriptor is to basically consider every pixel in the image that we have, and then by applying an orientation analysis, a step, for example, a Sobel filter, can be run over the over this image, and then for each pixel in the image, we can compute two orientations and their magnitudes. That is basically two vectors that characterize the edges, basically edge information at each pixel. And once we have these orientations, we can summarize them in a histogram that will then which will then characterize all of these edge orientation informations that are obtained from the global information in this image in one compact representation that we can then use to compare two sketch representations or a sketch representation and one non-photorealistic rendering. All right, so we basically have a mechanism for sketch-based retrieval to make the 3D object more comparable to the user sketch, and we have a representation by features that we can use to compare the objects or the renderings. So now the question is, how do we solve the pose problem? So basically the user sketch can be given in arbitrary orientation, and while for 3D object retrieval based on 3D objects, we have the PCA as a tool to come up with normalization of the orientation. Here, another approach that is commonly taken for sketch-based retrieval is to not try to normalize the sketch with respect to its orientation to the object, but to take a larger number of views from the 3D object and then compare each of these views to the user sketch, and then assuming that the one view which minimizes the distance between the user sketch and the object will correspond to the appropriate orientation of the sketch. So basically we are installing a camera system across these across each object. We generate a number of views, and then we compare the user sketch using the gradient descriptor against each of these views, and then taking the minimum overall views per object, and then coming up with a final similarity score that we can then use to rank target objects with respect to a user query. So far, the general structure of this of this approach, or one implementation that can be done to solve this problem, and as was already mentioned, evaluation is important in order to figure out which pre-processing steps and which feature descriptors perform well for a given application. So with respect to this application, we also in previous work did compile a set of user sketches that was used in our own experiments with respect to evaluating the performance of this method that I've just outlined. So basically we asked a number of colleagues from our institute to generate user sketches with respect to a number of object classes where we just gave users or our province the labels for objects we are interested in. We collected the sketches, and then we had a query base that was then the basis for an evaluation retrieval and evaluation of this retrieval algorithm. And then, as we see here in this result, this technique already works quite well for a number of basic object shapes. categories. For example, here in the cups class, we have a lot of, we have a number of relevant objects on the first ranks. We also observe by such evaluations that sometimes we have false positives, which are retrieval results that appear on early ranks in the ranking, but which do not correspond to the query class. So here, for example, in this hand class, we see a bird and a tool shape, which by the class label does not correspond to the query object. However, by some of its properties, it can be still seen as corresponding or resembling the query object to some to some extent. Generally, in feature-based approaches, such false positives may occur, and they are also not always easy to interpret because their rank is determined by the similarity function, which in turn is given by comparing dimensions of feature vectors, which are not always easy to interpret. So this is largely also an experimental task in order to compare which method works best, and so experimental evaluation is important. All right, so this framework for sketch-based retrieval is just one implementation that can be done, one approach, and also within the shape retrieval evaluation contest series, there has in 2012 been a first evaluation contest that examined performance of sketch-based retrieval methods. And without going into too many details, I just want to mention a couple of other approaches and their basic ideas, what they do, and to illustrate basically the many implementation varieties or variants that you can choose that can potentially all lead to different retrieval results. So one approach here, a very efficient with respect to processing time and also a very effective approach, was here presented by Matthias Eitz and colleagues. Here the idea is to sample, to generate features from the target shapes, not just using global views, but taking very many local samples from the target image by sampling many windows and having a description for each of these windows, and then indexing a bag of words representations for all of these local image descriptors as a basis for the similarity search. Bo Li and a colleague suggested a view context representation where we compare not just only a given sketch to one view of the target shape, but also to neighboring views that we obtain by shifting the camera around a little bit and then aggregating all of the distances that we get, and this can be shown to improve the retrieval precision for some orientation cases. Other approaches rely on shape contexts, where the idea is to index local shape properties, not only by local shape information, for example, an orientation of an edge at a certain position, but also by the configuration of other edges around the local point of interest, summarizing that in a histogram. That's one configuration for a description. Yet other approaches from Furuya and others take a look at or apply image analysis approaches like well-known SIFT analysis. SIFT features known from computer vision can also be applied here to find descriptors. And in another variant of the method that I have just presented, based on suggested contour images, as a variant to that, we can also test with different non-photorealistic rendering techniques, because this is obviously a parameter in the method. And depending on which kind of rendering method we take, different results can emerge, and evaluation is important here to compare different configurations of all of this similarity search pipeline that we can implement with respect to their effectivity. Following up on this 2012 contest, there was a follow-up with respect to the evaluation database. the 2012 benchmark contained a smaller number of objects and query sketches, and in 2014 we invited all of the participants from the initial Schreck initiative to again submit retrieval results based on an even larger test collection that was compiled for that purpose, and we were basically able to use a test corpus from Matthias Eitz and colleagues, who basically run a crowdsourced experiment to gather a large amount of user sketches. So particularly, they were using a Mechanical Turk system to gather about 20,000 user sketches that have been classified into a large number of object categories. And this, to date, represents a very large benchmark, a large test data set for a large variety of user sketches that can be evaluated for their, based on which the performance of sketch-based retrieval methods can be evaluated. And in that study, again, it showed that that an image-based approach, which considers edge orientations, was performing very well. In this case, the approach of Tatsuma did not compute an edge orientation histogram for one global image, but in fact a series of basically a pyramid of images was analyzed, where increasingly smaller local areas are considered for generating the edge orientation histogram, and then all of these histograms were concatenated, so basically collecting object information at multiple resolutions in one descriptor worked very well in this case, and provided the best results according to this study. But of course, as I mentioned here, many parameters, many implementation details can be changed, and the overall retrieval performance typically is evaluated by information retrieval measures like precision and recall plots. As we see here, that plots the precision of obtained rankings against the recall, and then you are able to quantitatively compare alternative retrieval functions, alternative retrieval similarity functions. Okay, so far our overview about shape similarity approaches for global similarity search, partial similarity search, and sketch-based similarity models. And maybe I can ask whether there are any questions so far at this point with respect to the three different similarities models that we have considered. Well, if not at this time, then let me continue with the tutorial presentation by now talking in the remaining time about existing resources for evaluation of shape retrieval methods, and by outlining some additional novel applications that we can build on mechanisms of shape similarity search. So, already mentioned was the International Shape Retrieval Evaluation Contest that is run since 2006, has been founded by Remco Weltkamp of Utrecht University, later on joined by Afzal Bodil from the NIST Institute in the US. It's a competition that yearly defines a set of retrieval, shape retrieval problems, compiles a benchmark data sets, where a benchmark includes test data plus label information that allows us to quantitatively assess the performance with respect to retrieval precision or runtime efficiency. And this data set is made available, then the community is invited to submit algorithms or particularly ranking results that are evaluated, compared, and finally described in a contest report. To date, more than 50 tracks have been presented, and this is a valuable resource in the field of 3D shape retrieval for the community in order to compare algorithms and do experiments. Just a couple of illustrative tracks here, if you would be interested in any of this work. These are good starting points for getting data and information about existing algorithms. So the generic shape retrieval track that was mentioned already contains generic objects from everyday life, as you could say it, including vehicles, cars, humans, animals, etc., plus a classification. Plus, here in 2009, 22 algorithms have been evaluated. The Schreck 2010 track on feature detection and description is a dataset that contains a number of object transformations that have been done for a given object, and that is particularly interesting for evaluating non-rigid retrieval methods, but also the and also the robustness and stability of these methods with respect to the size of the strength of the deformation and certain other effects that can occur, for example, noisy object details which can affect negatively the performance of the retrieval algorithm. And here this data set contains as a ground truth a correspondence between local points between the objects. So when you do local interest point detection for local description, you can basically compare whether your algorithm provides repeatable local interest point identification. So you can, of course, track the points on the ground truth over the different models, and you can basically compute an offset that can give the precision by which your local interest points are detected, as well as the stability properties of the descriptors can be evaluated. So if the object is deformed, how does your shape feature, your shape descriptor, how does it change for local interest points? And that is a data set which can answer such questions for a given algorithm. Yeah, in 2011, a face retrieval benchmark was provided. It was already mentioned, 3D face retrieval, face categorization classification is one important application, and face data is made available. Non-rigid retrieval in 2011 was addressed by one specific track where, again, a larger set of objects have been compiled, annotated, and provided. Already mentioned, the sketch-based retrieval track from 2012 contains a number of sketches and target objects. In 2013, also one track that addressed or supports analysis of partial retrieval problems has been compiled and made available, which can be used to support retrieval for example, range scan image applications, where the basic idea is that you have just one view that you acquire from a given target object. You acquire one range image, and then basically every query is a one range image, and then you want to compare this range image with target objects. So acquiring or generating real range image data sets is an expensive procedure, because you have to have a scanning environment set up, you have to position objects, you have to do the scans, and you have to collect the data. So in this track, the range scan imaging process was simulated by taking the target objects and then taking views from different perspectives, thereby simulating the range image acquisition process and coming up with point clouds and triangulations of these that will mimic the outcome of a range scanning process that can be used for evaluating partial retrieval methods. Further on, some other benchmarks considered in 13 also low or inexpensive device acquisition processes, where a data set for models captured with the Kinect system have been made available, because that may also constitute a shape retrieval scenario where users with a low-cost device do an acquisition and then want to go to a database to retrieve similar objects. Okay, now let me just very quickly in the remaining time survey a couple of additional novel application possibilities that can be, that are enabled by shape similarity methodologies, and that can change the way that, that 3D objects are modeled or restored, for example. One important paper from Funkhauser and colleagues in 2004 suggested modeling by example, which is a application that supports the modeling process, not by modeling every component from scratch, but having a system that allows an integrated modeling with a searching functionality where you can basically, for example, by a user sketch or by an annotation of an existing object part, you can basically indicate to the system what kind of components you wish, and then you can gather these components from the database and integrate them to a model. So the idea is to construct new models from existing model parts, and this can be implemented by, for example, doing a global search for a statue which is incomplete. Here, for example, a statue which is missing arms. Then by basically selecting the main area of interest that you have, you can go to the database, search for matching other statues, and then by cut and paste operations, transfer the geometry. So modeling, one important application that can be supported by similarity notions. One other novel application that was proposed as part of a research project in digital library applications was the support for analysis and data retrieval cases in the architectural domain. So architecture is one application where 3D object data are stored in large databases, in building databases. And then the question is, how can we index and compare building data? This is a problem where the global feature approaches typically will not be so effective, probably because for architects, not only the global shape of an object, of a building, will be of importance, but also structural properties of the buildings will play an important role. And to that end, one can rely on structural shape descriptors, where, for example, the connectivity information between rooms in a building is recorded, is captured in a building graph, and then buildings can be compared based on their the similarity of their room connectivity structures. And this is one important search notion, one important comparison possibility for buildings, as has been developed in this in the Bovado project here, which dealt specifically with the question for building data, how can these be indexed with structural features, among others. And then, among others, once you have such a structural representation, they also have a natural correspondence to floor plans, and that can allow an architect, for example, to sketch a floor plan, and then by extracting the room connectivity structure for a given level in the building, you can come up with similar buildings that you are interested in. Another application is in cultural heritage object processing. Here I want to mention one ongoing EU project that we have been working in so far, which deals with with respect to similarity search. This is the Precious project, which deals with basically the problem of reassembly of object fragments, 3D shapes of fractured objects that archaeologists want to reassemble. So reassembly of part objects is a goal in this project, as well as then the similarity-based object completion. So after a reassembly stage, which will lead to a reassembly result that may still contain some missing parts, then the first step is of course to do the reassembly, and then the second step is to fill in missing shape information to come up with complete objects. So this is in a nutshell the general problem of the Precious project, specifically in these work packages of fragment reassembly and similarity-based object completion, where we are working. The project also includes additional problems on measuring degradation effects over time in objects, as well as predictive scanning. And if you are interested more in some of these aspects, please come see me and talk to me or you. All right, where can similarity search methods help in solving such problems? One is following the modeling by example method. It's basically repairing by example. One solution or one idea to go here is to basically execute a partial similarity search for an incomplete shape object. We basically go to a repair database, executing a similarity search for an incomplete object, coming up with a close matches for complete objects, and then by subsequent alignment and geometry transfer steps, we can be able to complete the missing shape information. To that end, we need local shape descriptors, because the query is not a complete object, but we have to solve the partial to global similarity problem, and this can be supported by local shape descriptors. One question in this context is, of course, how do we populate the repair repository? To that end, the answer is twofold. So basically, on the one hand side, we can build repositories from existing archaeological 3D object elements that we can populate. And obviously, such repairing by example approaches, they get more capable the larger the repair repositories are. That's one approach. And the other one would be to populate a repair repository with a number of elementary shapes that could be parametric, for example, and that can be building blocks for filling in missing geometry, or at least make it easier for an archaeologist expert to do the completion, because the final result may not be directly obtainable by just taking existing geometry, but the archaeologist most probably will do some post-processing adaptations to finish the object. But by these techniques, we are able to help archaeologists along the way. A second problem here is, after reassembly has been done, and then similarity-based search may not work, because we don't have, for example, we would not find appropriate matching repair objects. Another approach to complete incomplete objects is to rely on information only from the object itself, and to that end, symmetry-based analysis can be useful, because many objects, many structures show some form of symmetry, and symmetry also has a lot to do with similarity also, because we are comparing objects across different symmetry planes. And while there exist a lot of approaches for computing symmetries based on the full geometric information, also in recent work it has been shown that we can also rely on local feature points, local interest points, to do the symmetry computation. And to that end, local interest point detections based, for example, on heat diffusion analysis can be useful to provide a small number of interest points which are protuned and form a good basis for evaluating candidate symmetry planes. So heat diffusion, in a nutshell, it's a heat diffusion analysis is a tool which analyzes the distribution of assumed heat across an object. So the heat function is defined for a point x on the shape at a point t after a point source has been applied to that point, and then we basically record the decrease of the temperature at that point, and the decrease of the temperature intuitively depends on shape information that governs the distribution of heat. So we are basically, so one approach is to basically look for maxima in this heat diffusion process. So those points that retain the most heat over time are sort of intuitively and extremal points, and we can use these as basis for evaluating candidate symmetry gains. Yeah, so then once we have identified a small number of interest points from this heat diffusion analysis, we can basically take any pair of interest points. So we do this in an exhaustive way because we have just a small number of interest points. So for each two interest points, we assume a symmetry plane between these orthogonal to the line between these interest points, and then we come up with a quality function that rates the fit of such a symmetry plane by taking into account certain measures for the possible symmetry between all of the other interest points that can be based, for example, on their distance to the symmetry plane, on the comparison of the heat values at these points, and different other quality estimations are possible. But the main idea here is to do the symmetry analysis not on the overall geometry, which may be unstable because the geometry is not complete, the object is not complete, it's missing parts, but just to do it on a small number of interest points. And as our results from Precious project here on some real data show that this works quite well for a couple of test objects that we have acquired here. So just a small number of symmetry planes can be found and used to reconstruct the missing object part by exploiting self-similarities. And again, the relation to shape retrieval here is the notion of using local interest points, local shape descriptors, to come up with solutions to the problem symmetry analysis here, in difference to using the overall geometry that we could also use, of course, but these local interest points methods are robust, can be robust with respect to missing geometry. Okay, so these are a couple of novel enabled applications that can rely on shape similarity. And to close with an overview of applications, let me just mention also the problem of repository exploration and visualization of 3D repositories. And once we are given a similarity function that can compute the distance of any two objects in the feature space, we are also able to apply clustering analysis techniques on existing shape repositories to allow users overviews of the content of a given repository with respect to finding out about what is in the repository and how which different classes exist and how we can explore them. So here is just one example of a visual clustering method that has been applied on one of the benchmark data sets using the depth buffer descriptor. What is done here is to compute a self-organizing map, which is a two-dimensional mapping of each object to a node on a grid. And the mapping is done in a way such that similar objects or similar vectors typically get mapped to the closed positions on this grid, and then we have a two-dimensional structure that the user can use as a basis to explore collection contents in a larger collection. So basically here we have clicked on some of these nodes and visualized some of these cluster elements, and an interesting observation here is that here on the top left part of this two-dimensional map we have thin elongated objects, while here on the other end of this map we have more volumetric spherical objects. There seems to be a transition between these elementary shapes where we have elongated but also volumetric objects or shapes here in the middle. And so basically such a cluster analysis, if the feature vector is effective for describing the shapes and if the projection and clustering does a good job, then actually we can come up with arrangements, two-dimensional arrangements of projections of 3D shapes that can be useful for exploring large data sets and provide new access methods for shapes. And this can be done also for other objects. Here we applied self-organizing map analysis on a on a CAPS database here. And here again we have an engineering problem in the sense that different features are possible and we have to kind of experiment with the feature vector representations and the clustering and projection techniques and figure out what methods work for which repositories. Okay, so that basically summarizes and concludes the tutorial. We wanted to give an overview of the problem of shape searching, giving an introduction to basic approaches for computing similarity. We took a look at several similarity models for global similarity, local similarity, sketch-based similarity. We took a look at applications and the notion of similarity of shape is really a very important one because it is very useful to generate, to realize and enable many applications, similarity search retrieval being one of them, but also other applications like cluster analysis, repository exploration, shape completion are enabled by the notion of similarity. And yeah, of course, the problem is far from being solved. So as you may have seen, there exist many parameters of these methods with respect to pre-processing, with respect to feature extraction. So this is just, evaluation is one of the open issues. Partial similarity search, non-rigid retrieval, these are problems that have only recently come into focus, while the field started with global similarity search around the 2000s. Now partial similarity and non-rigid retrieval are important research areas because they enable additional problems or solutions to additional problems. The search for or the research of similarity notions still, of course, needs to be expanded. So far, we introduced geometric features, but 3D models comprise much more information, of course, texture information, material information, process information, provenance, annotation. So the question is, how can we enrich the similarity notion, the similarity concept, by additional properties of shape? For example, for the CAT case, not only geometry, the shape, it's important, but also the function that shapes realize, and we should take this into account when creating similarity functions, similarity computation methods. What is stylistic, structural features? How can we describe these? Which shape analysis methods can produce features that we can compare, that can describe these properties? This is, of course, important and ongoing work. Yeah, there is, we see an emerging of big 3D data with the advance of low-cost scanning devices and industrial scanning solutions. So big 3D data will be a problem, it is already a problem. How can we efficiently and effectively classify, retrieve, annotate large amounts of scans, either from high quality scanning scenarios in industrial applications, but also for supporting commodity devices, consumer grade devices that will also create large amounts of 3D data. How can we support this? Some of the important applications we mentioned, modeling by example, shape restoration, these all provide just examples of many more applications that can be enabled. Yeah, so as part of this tutorial, we also compiled a literature survey in which many more details can be found in these regarding this material. And of course, if you want to have more information, if you want to have a copy of these slides, please send us an email, talk to us during the conference. And yeah, with that, let me conclude the presentation and thank you for your attention. And if you have questions, we are open to it now or later. Thank you.
Any questions from the audience? We have time for maybe one, because otherwise we're eating into the
maybe sort of to the first speaker, you mentioned sort of this assembly issue. And I think in some of the half sentences, you said you either sort of go for the object or object component or for the complementary set because of that little animal or so was broken into a lot of tiny pieces. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate that a little bit? Because complementary space looks frightening big in terms of complexity. So.
Yeah. Basically, for that specific application, the problem is that we have broken surfaces. And basically, if we want to look for complementary geometry, because we want to search the complementary geometry of one pieces, the authors provides a very nice representation, a volumetric representation, in which, for example, for one local descriptor, they compute a descriptor using the occupancy of the geometric part. And then they apply exactly the same concept in the other surface, and then these two descriptors, if you want to match two descriptors, if these two descriptors complete the histogram of the distribution, you can see that these two matching points are fitting. So that's why they compose this similarity model. And this similarity model is not a comparison, a built comparison of descriptors, but they want to
assuming,
the distribution.
You're assuming you have the geometry description of the unbroken object.
Because
it's not that you have fragments and then you assemble them. It's you have the notion and the knowledge of the complete unbroken object and then you assemble.
No, because it is computed on the fly. Basically, you can compute a descriptor for local descriptors for one surface, then you compute the local descriptors for another surface, and then we want to search points that has the complementary geometry. And this complementary geometry is because this point has a distribution of histogram, this point has another distribution, and these two distributions, when we zoom up these two distributions, this gives us a constant distribution.
But can you go to that slide? Is there anything? Yes. Mm-hmm. You have lots of little fragments where it's not clear where they belong.
Yeah.
Then, sort of searching in the complementary space, there could be lots of complementary spaces considering the complete object. So you don't really know where it belongs to. That's why I sort of was a bit irritated.
Yeah.
Because a search space is infinite.
Yeah.
And if it's irregular structures, it's even non-decidable, as we know from complexity theory.
Yeah. But here the idea is to try to compute a large set of different candidates matchings, and then how we decide if this matching is corresponding or not is because we have some constraints. For example, one of the constraints is that there were no pieces with intersecting geometry. That's one of the constraints. So basically, if we have a large set of candidates, many of these candidates are not the solution because certainly we can have interpenetration. So at the end, we can have only a few sets of different reconstructions for this example. And this obviously one of them can be the right one, but that's mainly the experience that authors have in the paper, that they can compute a lot of candidates reconstruction, then they apply the constraint, they filter all these kind of reconstructions, and then they have a very small set of reconstructions, and then they can decide. For example, an archaeologist can decide, okay, this is the right one, this is not the right one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So basically, this technique is just for helping to the person or archaeologist to say, okay, this is feasible or not. But in the reality, it's not a problem that can be easily solved, even for humans. Yeah. So that's why this can help to do so. Yeah.
I think we should probably defer further questions over to the snacks and coffee. We'll reconvene here at 11 for the next tutorial, which will be the Castle Engine tutorial. So let's thank the speakers again. And see you at 11. This time with Kairis Kamporelis. He's going to present the Castle engine, which you will use for us to do an X3D by example game program tutorial.
Okay. It's another door. Okay, thank you very much. I hope to make this a really practical session. So if you have a laptop or anything, you can I think you can plug it and hopefully you will be able to even follow the tutorial. That's my idea that maybe you can do it. If not, I will also do everything on the slides, of course. But basically, I invite you to just try it out yourself, because my kind of point is that it really works, it's really easy, and I hope that actually you will be able to replicate these games, I mean, replicate your own games, during this tutorial session. Okay. Basically, I have a kind of... I have three parts, but first I will just try and introduce my engine. Tell you a bit about its features, why I did it, and so on. We will have a kind of 5-minute programming crash course about using a model from Pascal. A lot of people are asking me why do you use Pascal, it's an outdated language, and to them I always answer it's a modern object Pascal. It's kind of different from what you probably learned in schools 10 or 10 years ago. So I'll show you about a little bit about this language. It's really nice for dynamic language. Okay, and then we'll jump to the main part. This is the creating games. We make a simple application, then we make a kind of first-person shooter game. A really easy one, simplified version, right? But it'll work, everything will work. There will be some monsters and so on. And then we'll actually start making a two-dimensional game. And then I conclude some more, and I'll show that the engine is compatible to various devices. I mean, it can run on standalone, like Windows, Linux, Micro 6, BSD, and so on. And it's also compatible, can run on mobiles, I mean, Android, iOS, iPhone, Android, and tablets. Okay, and then more platforms are coming, for example, the native plugin, the Mozilla Stuff plugin, the web browser plugin is coming very soon. And you know, other platforms are also in the making. I hope to have a WebGL version at some point. It depends kind of on compiler support. That actually doesn't matter at all. My point here was just that the engine supports various platforms and they will be growing. Okay. So basically, game engine is something that you use to combine 3D and 2-dimensional assets together. You just take one of possible scene formats is X3D. We also support other scene formats, like you can use Spine to export to JSON, and Spine is a very nice program to design two-dimensional animations, kind of using bones and everything. So you can use Spine, you can use everything that outputs X3D, you can use everything that outputs Collada, and many other 3 and 2-dimensional models. So it's kind of, we use X3D as, in one way, we use X3D as a very nice model to interchange data with other programs. In another way, we also use X3D as a scene graph. Everything that you load, whether it's Spine or X3D or Collada or anything, gets converted to a scene graph. It's basically a graph of X3D nodes, so you know this already. And then you see how it pays off. I mean, if you know X3D, you can do a lot of stuff using the engine, kind of, you know it already. The engine is open source, fully, so you can modify it and extend it as you wish, using the modern object Pascal. Like I said, I will demonstrate this language a little bit later. And also, please remind me if I'm talking too fast or anything, okay? So just shout at me when I think. Because I know these things and I kind of tend to speed up when I know everything, okay? So if I try to talk too fast or if I think I'm not understandable, just, you know, remind me about it. This is kind of a feature set. We do have a lot of modern rendering features. One of the reasons why I was making this engine was that at the time I started, there weren't much engines that were capable of loading an arbitrary two-dimensional models exported from anything, and then able to apply to them various modern graphic effects. And so I made the engine that supports for things like shading, you can go around or from shading or anything else. You have bump mapping, so you have a per pixel normal maps, you have mirrors, you have cube maps, you have color method actually too. You have shadow maps, you have shadow volumes, you have spin effects, programmable by also the shaders, like screen space upping occlusion, and many other effects. So basically you can do a lot of kind of modern looking games using this engine. That's kind of my point. And then you have a higher level API. Basically, what I said at the beginning is that game engine is like you take a lot of assets and combine them into something.
And you can, the idea is that, okay, this access can be really simple. It can be like something like, okay, take this three-dimensional object, it's X3D. Okay, so run this whole event processing machine that uses X3D, and that's it. But you can also apply some higher logic above it using Object Pascal. For example, you can say, okay, this object is actually a creature. So use artificial intelligence, implementing Object Pascal, and just make it move, make it see enemies, make it navigate to the enemies, or maybe run from the enemies if it's scared. And basically, you can use a lot of like ready components that are using X3D as a container, and they drive in the X3D model or any other three-dimensional model around the level. So it's a lot of stuff is very easy to use. And things like levels, creatures with ready artificial intelligence, and extensible artificial intelligence, you can also extend it yourself easily, and items, and actually a couple of other things kind of packed up and ready to use in the engine. You'll see that actually it's very easy to use. Okay, this is what that announced. Yeah, I hope that we'll be able to actually follow parts of this tutorial. You need basically, okay, first of all, you need actually two things. Lazarus, this is our programming environment. I'll showcase it shortly. Our engine is actually mostly a set of units, so you just install them inside Lazarus. I'll show it quickly. And sorry, for the tutorial, I prepared some example data for our games, so you can download it too. I'll link these links throughout the tutorial a couple of times, so if you want, you can download them now. I will also refer to them a couple of times later. Okay, I said most of these things already, right? So we support a lot of formats using any authoring tool. That was my kind of dream, and okay, it kind of works already. So you just use any 3D authoring tool or two-dimensional authoring tool and export to actually anything you want. You know, X3D is the best, but you can still use just any other format. And you can load it in our engine. So that's the point of the slide. Okay, I think I also told most of this already too, right? So once you import models, you have X3D scene graph. Whatever it was, a spike or other, whatever, you have X3D scene graph. So if you know X3D, you're already at home. We have import table, I mentioned this, and I mentioned already that you have an API for high-level stuff, like widgets and so on. We have a lot of documentation, and the slides will be available on the web, so you can look it up later, easy. And yeah, Lazarus, this is our programming environment. I mean, it's an editor integrated with the compiler, with the debugger. And you see it shortly, it's just a very, very cool software and we build on top of it. So our engine is just a package for it, you use it from there. Okay, first pick, Lazarus, I actually wanted to run it. It looks like just scratched, so I'm not cheating. Okay. And basically it looks like this. This is the main program bar. It created my lost project for me, so I don't want it. I create a new application. Okay, so this is just a program, visual programming environment. You have some you have a way to place some code. Okay, I'm sorry. I want to do that. No. Sorry, I'm not hitting the right keys when I'm not looking at the keyboard right now. But what I wanted to do was something to do with this. So this is an example code of an empty unit that actually doesn't do anything. It defines a form class. A form is just something that is displayed on a screen. We can configure what we have this form, we can visually design what happens on this form key. We have an object inspector that basically describes the properties of whatever I'm selected. And this is the main program bar. So for example, it's okay. And what we can do with it, we can only run this program and it's just a fully working normal program. Okay, it's compiling. My computer is a bit clogged up at the moment. So a second or two. I forgot to mention about Object Pascal is okay. So this is not the best example because it wasn't going fast, but usually compilation is very fast with Pascal. You just let's compile to native code. So basically, one of the reasons is that Pascal has a built unit system inside. So okay, the compiler knows what the unit is, what the module is, and it can compile on demand, recompile only what is needed in a particular case. Okay, so this is our program. It doesn't really do anything, it just displays a form. But it works. So this wasn't too impressive, but just to show you that it's just a normal programming environment. Okay, now if you speak of the engine, basically, it can, so I close this thing, and then, okay, once you download the engine, you'll see it has a couple of, basic structure looks like this, and the most important thing that you're looking for are packages. These are the things that you can install inside Lazarus. Package is actually just a collection. Okay, there are some components, things that you can register in a component palette. You see what this means actually in a second. And a set of units. So what you do when you open Lazarus, you just go on the package, you say open package file, you navigate to wherever you downloaded the engine. Here, packages, and you open something called custom components. And then you press use, install, and wait a couple of seconds, and it installs. Now, the result of it is that you have the components installed in Lazarus, visible right here, and we'll actually use only one of them, sorry, two of them, so don't worry, this looks like a lot. And that's how you use the engine inside Lazarus. So I'll show shortly how it actually looks like. Okay, actually, maybe we just start with opening some demo in the engine. We have a lot of examples. So, for example, we can open. Sorry. Yeah, so, let's try the Lazarus and all of the demo. Okay. And this is a really simple program. That allows you to kind of, it's a ready working 3D model viewer and XVD and VRML browser. That's just using our engine for anything. It has some code, but actually it's not an interesting code. The code is dealing mainly with showing the camera parameters and allowing user to edit them and then apply them back to the scene. Or can also make a screenshot. Yeah. So the code is really simple and not doing anything fancy. It basically says, take what user opens and display it, and you can see that it will work. I'm using an alternative compilation method sometimes, so sorry. Okay, in a second we'll see that it works, it compiles and works. And then, okay, let's just on this way. It's compiling right now to the native Linux desktop binder, so there's no magic here, it's just a normal compiler. The strategy to compile an Android version is that you have a special build tool that kind of wraps it up. But for the normal Linux or Windows version, you just press compile. That's it, you get an exe or binary file for Linux, and it just works. And so, okay, like I said, it's just ready fully usable model viewer. You can navigate wherever you want. You can open whatever you want. This is some example of a background animation. For example, I can show that I mentioned mirrors earlier in the engine, that the engine supports them. Okay, so I can show that it actually really supports them, the simple demo. So this is an XVD file, no magic here, I mean nothing that you see here is kind of hard-coded in the engine, it's just an XVD file, and for example, you can, using the touch sensor, sorry, the position sensor, I think, no, plane sensor. Yes, the plane sensor, you can drag things around, you can move them, then using the cube map environment texture, you can kind of take a snapshot, the cube map of the environment around you, and create a real-time mirror that is working. There are no shadows here, but yeah, basically the viewer doesn't download the shadows, but this whole scene can also cast shadows using the shadow balloon. So we just, okay, mirrors are working, it's not something very impressive, but okay, they're kind of blocking out of the box, so we need to do anything in the engine. Okay, if we just see, also, before we jump to the programming, I also wanted to mention kind of our most important tool. It's a View3D scene, it's a three-dimensional 3D viewer based on the engine. Actually, it's very similar to what we just ran here, but it has a little more options in the menu. Now, I'm mentioning it because it's a very useful tool when you design models for the engine. It's cool to kind of, before you load them in the actual game, just load them from the, before you do it, first try to run the build scene and see if it runs them okay, because the rendering built inside your PC is the same rendering that you have inside the engine. Okay, I can see the load. Okay, no, too long, too long. But this should be fast. Yeah. And this is just Shadow Volumes demo. Again, with parts that are editable using the plane sensor from XVD. So you can, well, you can mess around with this thing. But you can see that we have shadows for. And this is just with the seniors. Again, this is nothing. The very program with the scene didn't do anything fancy in the engine. It just said, okay, load the model and make give user a lot of many options, right? It's good, whatever. But the whole rendering, the whole processing of the interaction and the rendering is just, this is just a core of the engine, so you can just use it for yourself. Okay. Very short programming course, like I mentioned. Modern Project Pascal is really more similar probably to C++ and Java. So we have, it's an imperative language, but we have a mixed classes. So we have generics, units, classes, interfaces, runtime library that supports basically anything. It's an open source project, so there are really probably every library that you heard of. Not necessarily written in Pascal, so I mean, there are a lot of libraries written in Pascal for networking, database, and graphics, and really everything. But there are also a lot of wrappers around the native libraries written in web, usually in C. And you can interface with them, you can easily use them. So it's not like you're limited to what is written in Pascal language, you can easily use other libraries. Because it's just all compiled to the same native code, right? So there's no magic. Okay, some very simple examples of a Pascal program. This is really for those who even really didn't have a Pascal at school, so kind of looks easy, right? So you have the procedures, the parameters, you have a comparison, you can write something out, and you can use the procedure. Okay, this is so simple, I'm not sure if I should even run, right? So I just skip ahead. We have classes, so there's like a definition of a class in Object Pascal. This is the name of the class, and it's public section, there are fields, there are methods. In Pascal, string is a native type, so it's automatically managed because you can have any length. It's reference counted, but actually doesn't matter. Usually you just use it as you can add it, I mean concatenate it, and assign it, and it just works magically. Nothing too impressive, but it's just a normal class that you use. You can construct the class, right? So it's a dot create. Yeah, in a C language, you would write it like, just for those who. So this is what it says in Pascal, just for you coming from, and if you do this, you have to always declare the variable, and then you can construct an instance of an object, and I just made a memory leak, I shouldn't do this like this. Okay, in C, for example, so I mean, in C++, if you wanted to do this, the equivalent would be to just say, okay, declare the variable, and assign it like this. In Pascal, the parents, when there are no arguments, the parentheses are optional, but you can write. Okay, so this is end. Okay, so this is kind of, if you don't know Pascal, but you know C or any other C-like language, then this is the equivalent construction, right? Okay, I hope this is, I mean, so easy that even if you don't know Pascal, you'll get to pick it up, because there's really not too much to. Okay, units, a program can use units, this is the user's clause, and inside the unit, and inside the unit, looks like you have an interface section that declares what is exposed by this unit, like the procedure tool, and then it's an implementation of the unit. Yeah. Again, nothing fancy, it's just a normal unit system. Okay, let's jump into the actual engine. Yeah, I know it was very basic, and jump into the actual game programming. Okay, very short primer on using Lazarus to design programs. Okay, so we've seen that. Okay, let's start by creating a new application. I very much wanted to kind of replicate everything I do on the site, just to show you that it's really kind of easy. Okay, so for example, you can take a component from the component file and drop it on the form. The idea of Lazarus and actually the object pasta in general, it's not an object object pasta, but it's an idea of Lazarus, that every visual component that you see here, you can drop on the form, has an exact correspondence with an actual class implemented in the pasta language. So you know that these things, they are not some, you know, wrappers around the classes, they are exact classes. I mean, like your class must descend from a particular type called a T component, and then that's all you need. This makes the class possible to put on a form as a component. It actually has to descend from something more to be visual, like a pattern, but it can also be a non-visual, it can be a good one. My basic point was here that these things that you can drag around from here and put there. It's not some magic that's happening. I mean, what is happening is that inside, actually, the code is generated like this. Okay? It declared a field named button1 of class T button. And what is hidden from us, it's hidden in here, and actually it's also hidden in a T-form handling code. But basically, instead of doing this visual, you could also create a constructor for T-form, and in the constructor, create manually an instance of button, and using this thing, yeah, using this construction. So there's no magic happening. T-button is a normal class, you can construct it by code as easily as you can do by dropping the component on the form. That's something powerful kind of using the engine too. And once you drop a component on the form, you have in Object Inspector, you have a lot of parameters for it, so there are properties. Basically, things like fields, but you know, the getter setter wrapped in a getter setter. It's kind of like a C#, you know, because it's not a direct access to a field, but it's something that looks like a field from the outside, but actually, it's implemented as a get function that returns a value and a set function that may set a value with intention. And you can assign events, which are actually just callbacks. In Object Pascal, you can use functions as callbacks, just as if actually another programming language. So what happens here is that when I click two times on the button, actually I could also do this. It creates a callback for you. It assigns it to button1.onclick event, and you can use it. You can implement this callback by doing anything. Actually, I just show something, the simplest possible thing you can do with Lazarus is just use the show message method and that's it. Yeah. And it's our program that creates a button and this button does this. Yeah. So that's very impressive. But it's not my engine yet. Okay, I'm just doing this to kind of show to you that it's so easy to use Lazarus to design stuff. Okay, and now we will actually jump to the main engine part. Okay, so to make some 3D application, here's 3D application using our engine. Okay, so I advise those of you who want to follow us to download the sample models. It's on GitHub, Michalis Campi @cgk-tutorial. So you can download it using Git, or you can download the zip file from Git also. And. Yeah, so if you want, you can download the data from there. There are kind of three-dimensional data, and data for our three-dimensional and two-dimensional games. So if you want, you can download it here at home and test it yourself. Okay, so you can actually look what's inside there. And to not cheat, I can actually even edit. You know,
Could you put the link shortly back on?
Huh? It's on GitHub, Michalis Campi, and it's a GitHub tutorial. Okay, and I'll show you what this contains in a second. And yeah, I think I'll just delete the source code on the computer just to show you that actually can be what we do, can be really replicated within our short tutorial session. And it's actually three simple programs, simple three-dimensional game, then a little larger three-dimensional game, a kind of first-person shooter, and then a two-dimensional game. So I hope that you will see that it's all really easy to use. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this. this is the data that I'm looking for, and I'll do this, I'm cheating. And what this contains is just a simple three-dimensional model I created in Blender, and for the, you'll see that. So the first thing I'm doing, I'm just showing it in the completeness because it's kind of really useful thing to do when you design things in Cover Engine, is to open it with UV3D scene. It's something that really pays off just to see that your model is okay. So I'm navigating there, and there's this, okay? It's just a simple texture, simple model like this. Okay? Nothing fancy, but okay, and what you want to do? Okay, so you want to see the simplest possible code to actually load this in the game, and I'll explain, then I will have a chance to explain how our API, API looks like. So, this, and okay, so we start. Using the engine, the main entrance point kind of for the engine is that, okay, you have a core. Now, you would probably want to, now, if you have a form, you want to drop something that renders our engine data on this form. And this is called the T-Castle control. This is the main thing that you can, that looks like a, I mean, it is by default, it exactly is a viewport to your three-dimensional world. Actually, it can be, it's configurable, you can make it so that actually it contains a couple of viewports, it also can contain a GUI controls. Basically, it contains everything that the engine can render. In the basic state, default state is just it has a container for a three-dimensional world, and you just say, okay, just load objects there, and by default there's a camera setup that will render this world and will render it filling the whole area. Okay, so I'm just kind of emphasizing here that it's just a default setting, it can be configured to do a lot more. And okay, and the simple code looks like and the very simple code looks like this, okay? So what happens here, I will show you paste it, okay? So what happens here, okay, we want to use two units, these ones, and it may contain some stuff that's used here, it's obvious in a second. Okay, now we're attaching our basic handling in the engine. What we really want to do is we want to initialize our three-dimensional world with our new, we want to load a three-dimensional object and add it to our three-dimensional world. And basically, the engine will take care of the default of everything else because it will set up a camera. The camera will allow interaction with the object. The navigation of this camera is configured by the XPD scene. You know this, right? It's a navigation info node in XPD, and it says whether to use examine or walk or fly, other types of navigation. So basically, everything actually about the 3D interaction in the simple case is configured inside the scene. Okay, and the defaults are to use examine camera and just display, so it's visible. Yeah, so we don't have actually a lot of stuff to do, right? So we'll have to create a scene, it's called the custom scene, it's a basic container for a three-dimensional asset. We create an instance of it, and we make it owned by an application. What does this mean? I didn't mention explicitly, but there's no garbage collector in Pascal. It's like in C++, you manage memory yourself. You probably know this, you know the downsides and upsides already, right? It makes your programming kind of more demanding, you have to watch out. But then there are a lot of tools that catch the memory leaks, so it's once you get used to it, it's really not that demanding, it's manageable. And then you get a native speed, and then you get a really good speed out of the box, right? So basically I can load, okay, I did load a couple of large models in my engine, and I kind of often saw that I have a very good speed, very comparable with other engines, kind of out of the box, because it's just native code and the renderer is native code. But I do get some very measurable gains from the fact that it's only a native engine compiled to native code. And it's not something, for example, programmed in JavaScript or another interpreted language. So that's okay, just side note. And in this case, we don't actually need to worry about memory management, because we just say that application is a global object, singleton, owns this object called scene, it's owned by the application, and owned in object Pascal is a special term. It means that the application, when the application is freed, and it will be freed by the Windows system, it will automatically free also the scene. So actually in this case, we don't have to worry about the memory management, and basically what I mentioned this whole thing just to tell you that, okay, basically there is no garbage collection. Yeah, but as you can see, it's not so big a problem, because in this case we just say, okay, it's owned by the application, that's it. Is taken care of is taken care of for you automatically. Okay, so what you do, you load the three-dimensional object, and this thing just says to look for application data. It's used, for example, Android, where you can pack your data to build APK package. It's something that is packaged on an Android device. So this is very, very useful instruction to seek for data. And then what you do is use scene manager, right? Custom control one is what you created by dropping the control in the form. Now, this I mentioned that this the main purpose of it is that it holds a knowledge about three-dimensional world. And this three-dimensional world, it's called a scene manager. It's where you have your scene. The idea is that you can have many three-dimensional, three or two-dimensional scenes inside your model. And there must be some central knowledge about it. For example, when you make a mirror, so there's a teapot reflecting a world. So you want this teapot, even if this teapot is part of a larger, is part of a single X3D scene, right? But your world contains, for example, this one three-dimensional scene with a teapot, then it contains also a dinosaur and it contains also a player. And once you make a mirror inside one of these models, you want this mirror to reflect everything, right? Not just this particular three-dimensional model that is in, but you want this to reflect the level, the dinosaur, the player, and everything you want done. Right? So for this, you need a scene manager that is basically just, and in a simple, it's not really like that, but basically it's a list of three-dimensional objects that you have loaded. And actually it is like that, but much more complicated in implementation. So what you do is just you say, okay, so a scene is part of this three-dimensional object, and you say that the main scene is what we have just created. The main scene is something, and in X3D you have a couple of bin-label nodes. They are nodes that govern, that can only, they make sense only when used once. I mean, okay, they are make sense only when one of them is active at a time. There's a navigation info, it's a fog node, it's a background node, and there's some for the type of that which one. But basically there are some nodes that, you know, only one of them makes sense at a time, right? And a viewport, yeah. Only one of them makes sense at the time, and the main scene basically says, okay, which three-dimensional object decides what is the viewpoint, so what is the starting for player position and direction looking, and what is the starting navigation info and the background and so on. Okay, so that's the meaning of this stuff. Okay? I won't talk so much about, I won't talk about every slide so long, but I just wanted to explain to you the very basic engine API, okay, and just to quickly show that I wasn't completely running. I actually tried to run it. Okay. I just copy and paste here. Okay, we have created this already. That's good. Now, when the form is created, so I just click on the form, I click on events, and I see there's an onCreate event. It actually happens at the same time, at the end of constructor. Nothing exciting, and I say, okay, implement this like this. And so it's basically exactly what we have seen. Oh, and I need to use custom files with the custom scene. Yes, I can use them. I think I can use them right here. There's code completion and every other modern feature we expect from a programming editor here. I won't even save this project because it needs to be now in a directory that contains as a subdirectory that our data, that contains the metric, our asset. So it needs to be able to find our asset. So I do want to save it inside this directory. I could probably use a better project name. And the unit name too. And I just wrote it. Okay, it worked. What it did actually, again, it still didn't do anything impressive, right? Because we just loaded a two-dimensional scene, and like I said, the default canvas example. That's it, but it works. And now, onward to something more impressive, okay? So, we start to make a, let's try to make a three-dimensional game, a kind of first-person shooter. And what you've seen here is that actually you can let's start with a level. A level is the basic field that the player walks on, that the creature walks on, and so on. Now basically you can just use the existing code that you have seen to just load the three-dimensional model and say, okay, it's part of the world, and it's a level, yeah? it's nothing actually fancy that you need to say about the level. But actually, there is something that you can say about the level in the useful. Because, for example, when you design a level in Blender on VS Max or in another authoring tool, a really useful thing to be able to do on a level object is that you would like to place, use something called placeholders on the level. It's basically there are things that say, okay, this is the place where you should spawn a creature, this is the place where you should place an item. And yeah, actually, you can probably imagine a lot of users, but in a basic version of it. So, our model for level looks like, okay, it's not this one actually. Okay, so this is basically why we kind of wonder even here about creating something else, about using something else for loading a level, some more higher level function. And I want to open this, and this. Okay. Oh, and there's nothing. Nothing is usable. Oh, this and this is nothing usable. I didn't want to show anything in particular here, just to show you that it's a normal. Okay, yeah, now nothing is usable. Okay, it's just a simple three-dimensional model done in Blender. And if I wanted to, now I could create some. I could drop some cubes on this level and say, okay, there are places where the items, where the creatures will be spawned. Actually, open something different. Okay, something is visible. Yeah. And this thing, these cubes, they will not be visible in an actual game, but they have special names. Like this. And they have special names because that start with cast rest. It's a shortcut for abbreviation for cast to game engine resource. And then there's the name of the resource. I will explain it in more detail in a second, but you can actually probably guess what it is already. It means that to take the resource from medkit, it's defined elsewhere as an item, and to put it on our level at this place. And that's it. Yeah? That's kind of nice functionality that you want to have in your level. Your game designer, your level designer can just place initial things on the level inside his editor. And we have this function, text placeholders is plugable, which basically means that it supports Blender or any other rendering software you want to write. You can configure how the text placeholders. I said it already, I emphasize it. The idea of our engine is that you can really use any authoring tool to design two-dimensional stuff that's usable in our engine. Okay. So, loading the level, I basically mentioned here again the same data link. Okay. Now we can test our level by opening in view 3D scene. I won't do it this time, but it's really something I advise you to kind of do constantly because it's a really good test. Now what we want to do is we want to include a three-dimensional level. This is for now not important in the first line. What is important here is that how we use a level. Basically, we create another format, a very, very simple XML file that refers to the two-dimensional file, like bridge underscore final, is the name of our file, created by partial Blender, also by manual editing, I will talk about it in a second. And it says, okay, I use Blender for it. We have to declare the model we use because to detect placeholders. I emphasize this is the only purpose of it is to detect placeholders correctly because various authoring programs they convert their object names, I mean Blender object names, like here cast ResMedKit, to X3D in various ways, right? There's no standard about it. I mean X3D has something called name of an object. But some exporters use it in one way, some use it in another. So that's the purpose of this placeholders declaration. We have to actually know what and how produced these names to be able to detect them. The most important part here is bridge. This is the updated file that we will use to load the model. And actually, there's the second thing that is important, but we will not use it at the level. It says to use the basic level object for our level. You can also specify here more things, you can specify here a class that descends from a standard level implementation and enhances, for example, adding some elevators. Adding any kind of logic that you would like to place in a class descending from level. So that's kind of a thing that the whole system is extensible, right? Here we just say, okay, give me the standard thing, but we could send it to do something more. Okay, so the logic level is really simple once you have DOM created this XML file. And you just use these two simple lines. This says to scan the directory, the data directory, for files named level.xml, right? So our data looks like this. It's a level.xml that contains what I showed you. This is the contents of our level XML. And our function log from files, we just scan the directory for levels defined like this, and then it says, okay, so load the level name bridge. Anything, nothing impressive again. I will show Costa. And I just have to kill my and okay, so let's just very quickly a new. Okay, I'm not because I see I'm running a little out of time, but I was prepared for it. Okay, so for this part, I will cheat a little and I will open a ready project. One, using it. Okay. In this case, so we have to write it from scratch. And now, let's overload my applications. Sorry again. Yes, we have no, okay, sorry for the. Aggressive about automatically saving my useless example code that I wrote a second ago. Okay, so what I have just shown on the slide is these things, right? So we assign a callback to our, we drop a custom control on the form and we create an event, I mean, we assign it to an event called onOpen. And in this event, we start doing our stuff. Basically, what I'm showing you right now is just we scan for levels, and we load the level called bridge. Okay, is this form readable for you? The form, the size, yeah, it's okay? Great. So we just have loaded the level, the simple possible way. So okay, how do this define items and creatures? Yeah, so I was advertising that okay, it's so easy once you have this engine set up. And okay, it actually is. So once you have a level, you have something called the resource system, which basically means that the data is scanned for files named resource.xml, kind of similar to level.xml. And inside they look like this. So again, there's a reference to our three-dimensional model created in Blender, exported to XVD. And there's an identifier we will use shortly to actually place this on a level. And you can specify what object class is used to implement. Okay? So there's really not much to do to use it. I'll run it shortly with the example just to show you how it works. Just to use it in your game, you just say, okay, resources dot load from files. And what it does is it scans your data directory for resource.xml files and will load the items and creatures found there. Okay, so this was so simple that I think I even move on from forward. And this means that in Blender you can place the placeholders as shown to just place the items and creatures on your level. Okay, so actually I explained this thing, and now this is a short screenshot. Okay, now I'll run the example in a second, okay? But okay, I run it right now and I explain what I want to do. Okay, something happened, it loaded the level. There's a short animation going on around. Now what you see is that there is no monster creature spawned on the level because I actually didn't use the correct models yet. I used the ones that the pro demonstration proposes. They did not contain the levels and items definition, but I can just do that. This here says okay, bridge. We will solve. Now I'm fumbling here with X3D written in a classical coding, as you can see. So okay, there's no surprise here. I was telling you a lot later, earlier. A lot of things you can do in the engine, you're just doing X3D. So for example, right now we have a level object that is called bridge_final X3D path, yeah, classical coding. This is the thing that is referenced by the level XML file. Yeah. This refers to this file. And this file is written manually by hand, and it inlines what Blender produced. Why? Because Blender has an exporter that lacks some features. For example, it cannot create a good background node. It cannot create a spotlight node, really short with some kinds of stuff. And it also cannot create a really good viewpoint node. I mean, it messes up gravity. These are details that are not really important. They're only referred to the Blender problems of Blender. The point here is that we can easily overcome them. They just write a couple of lines in VRML or XVD manually and inlining our thing in exported from Blender. Okay. So actually, it's useful that I made a mistake. Thank you. Okay, that's worked. I was dropping the cubes without much thinking on the level. And there are some features I will show shortly how. I just pick an object. Okay. You can pick items, these guys attack you. They are really poor at this, but they try to attack you, and you can try to pick up objects, items, I'm sure shortly how to do it. Okay, that's not the end actually. What can be done? I wanted to show one additional stuff, but basically now we can now I have to explain how to do everything here by code. Okay, so what happens, okay, but what we have shown right now, seen right now, is that, okay, spawning of items works and really required almost no code, right? I mean, what I showed you was that you do resources.load from files, like here. So I said, okay, find the resource.xml files in your data directory and just load it, okay? And this means that the items and features will be spawned on the level. Okay, now what can you do more? But there's something like a player. It's useful to define it, to have some inventory in game, for example, yeah, because now we have seen that okay, we can drop an item on a level. That's really just this one line, yeah, resource.load from file, this is one line. But to pick them up, okay, there's an automatic inventory management in engine implemented. If you want, you can use it. To do it, you just instantiate an object of class player. So we just create a player, we add it to scene manager, and we move forward. So it's really not much to explain here, because you have seen this pattern already. So this is here, and that's why picking up objects works in you have already seen it in example. Okay, but by default, what happens is that okay, you pick up objects, but it doesn't mean anything. I mean, it means that they disappear from the level, and they do appear in your inventory. Your inventory by default is just a list of items, and there is no magical logic that says what happens when you pick an item, and there is no logic that says okay how to use an item. That's the thing that you have to implement in your own game, of course. And also, there is no default way to display items, right? That would be bad. Various games want to have various GUI and so on. So, what you can do is actually you can very easily create your own GUI. I showed very briefly here because this is actually not so important, but basically you create a class that descends from T to I control, and inside this you can render stuff. You can render two-dimensional stuff or three-dimensional stuff. In the simple case, I'm doing okay. Let's take a player, and the player has inventory, okay? So iterate over inventory, and each item inside is and you have an item inside. Now, by default, it items in inventory as okay, boom. I'm skipping over here fast because it's really not an important thing. I mean, it's something useful in the engine, but it's just a detail that you can, of course, configure and extend however you want. But so items have a quantity, and I'm saying, okay, so for every item, display its thumbnail, that's its image, as many times as it's owned by the player, and move a little to the right. So that's why on the example, you've shown that when I was picking up items, they just appeared and at the lower bottom, left bottom part of the screen, and this is the first one. And the second one is moved 100 pixels to the right. That's really simple. Okay, so picking up objects, okay. Oops, sorry, not so fast. Okay, so picking up objects was very easy because you basically create a player and everything else is managed. Okay, everything else is managed for you. Actually, not everything. For example, you have to display the items on a hood, but it's just simple to add. Okay, now what to do with creatures? Okay, creatures are going to be as simple, or also as simple. Actually, we did everything we need to load the creatures already because we just used the resources.load from Firestore that we already have started to load our items. And this allows you to load creatures that are defined in pure XML file. I'll show it here. Okay, it looks like this. Now, I have left here some comments, but they are not so important. The main point here is that this is an XML file. And it says, okay, the main part says, okay, it has a couple of animations. They could be in XVD format. This is a dynamic format that is basically a wrapper around an XVD files. Okay, again, this is a detail I don't want to go into because it's kind of related to that Blender has kind of problems exporting animations, so we kind of overcome them by a wrapper around. But again, this is not important. For an outside point of view, it's just that, okay, we list five models, and we say, okay, these are the animations we want to use for our feature. And the important thing is at the bottom. Sailings. Okay, the important knife is right here. We just name our knife. It is an identifier, the knife. And we'll be able to use it shortly. And then we say that the type of it is a walk attack. As always, in our definition of resources and levels, we refer to a name of an object pascal class that is actually implemented these creatures, these entities, right? In this case, it's a creature. The thing is that you can register your own classes implementing your own artificial intelligence. They can descend from the basic creature class, or they can descend from the ready class that has some artificial intelligence already built inside, like the walk attack class. The walk attack class basically says walk around until you see an enemy. When you see an enemy, walk toward it until you're at a comfortable distance, then attack using some. You can shoot or you can do a short range attack. This is used right here, it's short range attack. And once you're scared, run away. Yeah. So there's actually a lot of configurable things in this XML that I didn't use them here, but you could configure your creature a lot by XML. Actually, I think I'll link it shortly for you. Just to kind of emphasize that a lot of things are possible without even knowing the programming language, right? So that was kind of the point where I'm using the XML files all around. Yeah, I'm not doing everything by code. I could configure all these parameters the object Pascal code, but if I want to, I can also configure them, a lot of them, in an XML file. And this allows the game designer, the level designer, to configure a lot of parameters around your game, around your creatures, without any programmer involvement. Right? And you can, of course, expose more parameters using in your own code, for use in this XML file. So this is an extensible mechanism. And this is Okay, this is everything you can configure in a default walk attack creature, like so the default values for everything. So there's really a lot of them, you know, of course not talking about all of them, but it's really a configurable artificial intelligence. So kind of attacking a couple of points here. Right? You can implement your own from scratch that you can extend from this thing, and you can just not do anything and just get something that is kind of a feature which already. And nothing actually is required to make this feature works. What you have seen is two nights that are already visible. It's already running. What we have seen is demo, these two knights that are already attacking me and walking toward me, walking toward the player. They did not require any code at all. We just dropped them in Blender, a placeholder called cast res knight. Okay, that the Blender open here. But this was just one of these cubes here. I showed you these cubes that are named cast res medkit, and there was another one called cast res knight. No surprise here. Okay, it's working. Stop. Okay, so basically to spawn the creatures we didn't have to do anything. So these two things are these two creatures are already given for us. I think a level designer just set them up and so on. Now, if you want to set up items by code, now that's where the identifier resource comes to use, right? Because this called this resource is called a knight, and this is something that we can use from our programming language, probably Pascal, to find this resource and instantiate it by code, and kind of actually we can also tweak a lot of this, I mean, actually all of these details by code. So again, it's XML or Pascal, you can do it from whichever place you like. I have a short slide of spawn creatures. We have actually two slides. So basically, you decide where to put a creature. Of course, we have a vector library in our engine, so you can calculate the position of the creature. Like take the player and move forward 10 meters. 10 meters is like an XVD, right? It's like an XVD. I mean, it's a convention that 1 unit is 1 meter. It's just a convention. We decide what is true, so what is the default direction that the creature is looking at, so it's right here. And then you say, okay, now we will find a resource called knight. This is where we use this name in XML, we load it to Pascal, and you say, okay, now create it, simply adding it to our three-dimensional world, and this is default position, default direction, right? So, nothing impressive, but that was kind of my point. You don't need to use a lot of code or anything to spawn a creature, and it's completely configurable here. When it will be spawned, how it will be spawned. Right in my demo, I think I plugged it in. Yeah, it's right here. So I just created the button descending from a speed button. It's a special Lazarus class. This is a kind of a speed button. Its difference from a normal button is that it doesn't get the keyboard focus. It's a detail that, you know, when you make a game, you don't want some other control capturing your focus, capturing your keyboard events, because it will capture them and not pass the keyboard events like arrow up, arrow down to our control. And this is a completely irrelevant detail, actually. So I just created a button and I implemented this event and I said, okay. So when it happens, you create a creature and you place it on the world, and it's just like this, okay? So we should see shortly that it's working, unless I have it running. No, I have it running. Oh, okay, but I died. Okay, this one that I didn't mention, okay? They managed to kill me, actually, when I was talking. Because one thing that I didn't mention, but now is actually a good time, is that we also have an automatic management of life of a creature, the things that we spawn, and of a player. Yeah, once we instantiated an instance of a class called player or a creature, they have a life, they have a maximum amount of life. And you will notice that when we defined our creature, we said that, okay, it can attack, yeah? And this is damage. Yeah? So it's 1 plus random 1. It's or if you want to see it, it's this. Yeah. I know I have to do the multiplication, yeah. But this is the damage that the creature will do. So, and the player has by default 100 life. So I was talking online. Okay, so this works, and okay, by default there are no effects. Okay, there's a knockback effect actually, sorry, that we have also defined in XML file. It says that the knockback distance is 4 meters, so when you are hit, you are getting a knockback. I mean, you are moving forward. Oh, come on. Okay. And they attack you from the other side too. Okay, we have a kill button, I'll show it shortly, it will be easier then. What I didn't want actually to show you at this point, but I did, is that the creatures can attack me and can kill me. This was one point. And the other thing that I wanted to show you, as this guy let me, was that the spawn button works. Yeah? We just spawn a creature and they land on top of each other when they are too many of them. Okay. Physics go wild sometimes, but basically one of them will probably manage to go downward and then. Yeah? Because when we spawn creatures, we didn't check whether the field was already empty. In normal game, before spawning like that, before passing the position of a creature in direction, we should actually check whether it's sensible, I mean whether there's nothing colliding at that point, because otherwise we can insert the creature inside another creature or inside the wall, and of course it will not work. Yeah, this is the case with all physics engines, when you insert one object inside another, and then basically exploding stuff. So that's why the artifacts, when they stand on each other, are a little bit acceptable. I mean, they won't crash your game or anything, but okay, you can expect that the physics engine will just try to push the things outside, but yeah, it's just a heuristic. So it doesn't work immediately, and it doesn't work nicely visually. Okay, I spawned all these guys, so they are facing by default. So they have the same direction, look direction as the player. That's why they are their backs are to me. So actually, they don't attack me because they don't see me at the beginning. Only once I get inside their pupils, then they are seen. Actually, the view cone face. They see me and then they will attack, they walk at me and they attack me. Okay, let's try to kill them, okay? Because this is getting a lot absurd. Okay, how to kick creatures? Well, basically we have collision detection built inside the engine. We are not integrated right now with any physics engine, but this is actually something very ongoing. I want to integrate my engine with Bullet, so this gives us a rigid body and solid body implementation. For now, we have a simple physics engine built inside the physics built inside the engine. It gives us gravity, it gives us collision. So, for example, you can query, okay, send a ray from player where the player is looking, and wonder what hits. Okay, when a ray hits something in three-dimensional world. It's a hierarchy of objects. So, for example, you have because in the scene manager that you've shown seen before, as I told that in simplifying things, it's just a list of three-dimensional objects. I was lying. It's basically, actually, a list of transformations, and they have another as their children. There can be more transformations and so on. So, it's actually a tree of three-dimensional objects with transformations along the way, and that's why our result of a heap is actually a path. In this tree, right? So there's a root, and there's, for example, something owning all the objects, and then something owning our creature, and then something, our creature is actually two things. It has a three-dimensional objects kind of holding together our creature, and underneath there's one animation, or the other animation, or the other animation. This is kind of an implementation detail that is actually exposed in this case, because, every such case is exposed in this case, because every hit is a list of objects, right? So this is kind of unavoidable. When you wonder what did you actually hit, you have to scan this full list and look for something that is alive, that is descending from a tab with the alive class. And this will allow you to detect whether you have hit a creature or not. Yeah? And if you have hit a creature, you can do whatever you want. In this case, I used a ready method called hurt, and it says, okay, make some damage, 100. And this damage comes from some direction, and it has a knockback value, The idea is that when you hit a creature, it can be moved back, just like you saw that when a creature attacks the player, there's a default knockback mechanism. The same thing happens when you attack the creatures. This is very configurable, and you don't really have to use this, right? So I'm kind of open for science here that the creature adds you a lot of default stuff. Like you get life points, and you get knockback, and you get some other things, but you don't have to use them. You can implement them your own. You don't have to use the hard method. You can implement your own big way of damaging creatures or another kind of mechanism. What we did here is, okay, we have used actually this default mechanism just to show that it's okay, so easy. So, it deals 100 damage to a creature, and okay, we say break. Break is the same thing as in C or C++, right? Just break the loop. So when you have found that you have hit a living object, halt it, and go out. And this is the way how to kill creatures. Okay, they managed to push me actually outside of my level. So I try to restart. Okay, and this is what we got so far, right? So we can pick up objects, and this button, kill, will allow me to finally get rid of these guys, and that's what happens. There are no fancy effects here, I mean, there's no weapon, okay? This is one thing that we didn't implement here. We just made a button that does what I showed you, that just sends a single ray through the middle of the screen, so okay. And it looks what it hits, and it hurts it using 100 damage. So when I try to pick it here, I didn't mention anything, but when I do this, okay, I am a little wild, but we'll see what happens. Yeah, so I'm probably killing some of them right now. Yeah, maybe, yeah, okay. Sometimes I do hit one of them, okay? And now I'm standing on top of one. You see that it works. Yeah? And again, remember that these artifacts that they are standing on top of each other are just because our spawning routine was lazy. Yeah? They didn't check whether the spawning point was clear before doing it. Okay, that was interesting. I do a little talk while it runs boots up. I think it's just overheat. We can do more. Yeah. So I showed you spawning, I showed you killing creatures. Actually, I think I've shown most of the FPS game right now. What we can do more is actually you can dive into XPD, right? Because what I have done up to this point is, okay, I've shown you that you can load a three-dimensional model and you can add some logic to it, like it's an item, it's a creature. It was also easy. But I kind of advertised it in the beginning that it's all connected with X3D. I didn't actually do a lot of X3D programming up to this point because I kind of didn't have to, yeah, because okay, I had it all prepared. Yeah? So now let's make a little bit of X3D programming. We will load a level, and we will see that once you name a node in XPD, you can actually query for it, and you can change its property like using a script in XPD, right? The thing is that in XPD, when you're doing the programming inside that XPD file, you have something called a script node, and this is something that reacts to the event in your scene. Now, when you program using our engine, you have actually two options. You can do the same thing, I mean, you can listen to an event coming from a scene, and you can react to it. That's obvious, you can do it. But you can also do another thing. I mean, you actually have a ready engine that runs all the time. So you can react to things like keyboard input or mouse input. Actually, these are actually also sensors in X3D. But you can, for example, react to things like database input, network input, things like implemented outside X3D. You can listen to it, you can react to it. You have also something event that is run every frame. And you can run your own routine there. For example, you can modify the two-dimensional object there. What I wanted to show you is that we can find the light node in XPD, and we can dynamically, I mean, using our object Pascal code, we can animate its direction or the position. I don't actually remember which one, but we will see. Okay, so once the screen puts up, we will see that we can find an XPD node and animate it by code, and that will be one of my points. Okay. Here, I just talked a bit more about what I want to show next. And also what I wanted to show is that we can easily use a lot of effects in our engine. A lot of them are configurable without any logic Pascal code. It's just XPD extend. They are just XPD extensions. For example, we have simple thing to turn on shadows in the engine. You just, inside the light node, you place a field called shadows, and it's a boolean field, and you just say shadows true. So, okay. And I will do true. There's not much to talk about because you just turn on the shadows, and the idea is it works automatically. Correct. Okay, so two things. And the third thing, once it boots up, is that this will be the end of the three dimensional part. I will very briefly show the two dimensional games now, too, and then we will jump to the conclusion that it will be actually more or less in time. Using Linux here, but it's a normal programming environment for Mac OS X and Windows and so on. Simple way to turn shadows. We just go to our XPD file and find the FIZ spotlight. Now, it actually does two things. Okay, by default, it's nothing interesting. It's just a spotlight. Now, we do two things. First of all, we name it using the standard XPD mechanism, and we will see that we can use this name called sun very soon. And we also, let's also do the second thing. So we uncomment these lines, okay? So this just shows shadows true. And I'm not lying completely, okay? So this is all that is needed to make shadows, but actually, to make them look pretty, you can also add this section that basically configures the resolution of a shadow map. If you don't know what it means, it's basically the larger the better. That's, it's a gross oversimplification, but that's basically what it means. And how often to update it. For example, you can update our shadow map only once at the beginning of the game, and this means that shadows will not be real-time. But if you update it always, it means that every real-time change, for example, when a creature moves, when an item moves, will be reflected in the shadows. So this line basically says, okay, I want real-time shadows. I know that it will cost me a little because it requires regenerating the shadow map every frame. But okay, I want it. And this thing is to fight with the shadow map artifacts. I don't want to go into detail. They basically should be calculated automatically for you. Here I use kind of exaggerated values to be safe, actually. Didn't want to. Yeah. So, okay, let's run it. Now, shadows will be shown. That's one thing. I can enable them. I just edited the XPD file. Yeah. I emphasize it. I didn't need to do any coding to do it. And the other thing that I did, is that I kind of announced it before, is that we can easily find an XPD object in our scene, and we can animate it. How did I do that? Find it. So basically, slides. Yes. So basically, we use a what we call find node. And there's the description. Actually, told you even more. Now, how to use the XPD node in our code. So basically, we have something like a scene manager. Actually, we have a scene. It's something called the root node. This is our scene that in XPD. Now, we can take it and just, this is just an assignment, sorry, the root is the is our XVD scene graph. And now you can find the sum. We just find it using the method find node by name. Nothing fancy here, right? Find node by name, and we want this node to be of type spotlight. This is important to for type checking, right? Because otherwise, without this line, a user could define a node name, a user, an author of the level, could define a node named sum and use it on, I don't know, a mesh, geometry, or shape. Yeah? And then our code would find, well, it wouldn't be correct. So I'm checking whether it's correct by using cast, the spotlight node. I mean, by using a cast and also by searching only for spotlight nodes that are named sun, this is actually the thing that gives you security. And once I found it, I can use it, I can change its properties however I like. For example, here I assigned to the onUpdate event, it was around every frame in our engine. And I said, okay, this is our location, it's just a three-dimensional vector. So just animate it, right? We have something like a time to seconds. This is the time in seconds that from the beginning of our work, so from the running of our game. And okay, so just take this time, take a sinus or multiply by 10, whatever, to make some round nice number that looks sensible, and use this vector as a new value of some location. This does the same thing as you would do in XVD scripts if when you send the value inside the exposed field, right? So it's really going through the normal mechanism, it's not some backdoor. It's going through the normal XVD mechanism to modify stuff. And again, I died. Okay. Okay, there are shadows. They are not too impressive because I set the resolution by default for my computer and it doesn't really look. And this shadows are not visible at all here. I'll just pretend I have a good GPU and we'll see what happens. Okay. Let's see if this demo can work on my laptop here. Nice shadows. Just a new jump, we jump for about 5 minutes into making a two-dimensional game. It's really so simple that actually I don't think it will be okay if I just show it. Okay. And yeah. And you can see two things now, that the frames per second are kind of lower. Because my laptop is a really old laptop. So this is something that you won't see at your own computers unless they are really ancient. And what we can see here is that the real-time shadows work, because animation of the night is affecting what is displayed, and also animation of the light is affected, right? The light is going weird all this time, and it's bouncing there, changing its x-coordinate. And yeah, thank you. Okay, the light is going wide and the shadows will be red. Okay, so now just reboot one more time and show you the two-dimensional again and we'll do a short video. Okay, sorry for the technical problems, but still in hands. Okay, I can start talking about two-dimensional game. And the idea is that, as in Unity and as in many other game engines, two-dimensional programming is just a subset of two-dimensional programming for us. What we do is we have a scene manager that kind of assumes that things are two-dimensional. What it means is that we have a viewpoint that by default looks... this is orthogonal. I should start with this. I mean. It's not a by default in two-dimensional games, you use a perspective view, which basically means that things are smaller, are perceived as smaller when they are farther away. That's normal. For two-dimensional games, you can want to turn this off. You want to also do some other stuff that is not that interesting. For example, you want to turn on blending sort. Basically, a couple of technical details have to be adjusted for the default scene manager to work perfectly in two-dimensional case. But still, these are only details that I don't even want to go into right now because they are not actually that interesting. My point here is that once you have a two-dimensional scene manager, you actually use it exactly like we created creatures, items, MapKit, or the simple first PD application where we have just loaded a simple mesh to our model. So basically what we do, we load an object and we say add it to a scene manager. And we say, okay, we want this to be a two-dimensional scene. It just means that we get a good camera for a two-dimensional scene and basically nothing more. So, because we don't need nothing more, that's actually, that's my point. A two-dimensional version of our engine, it doesn't require some new approach or anything. And that's why I believe I will be able to show it to you kind of quickly. Yeah, we will see, I will instantiate a short level, a short background, and then a short dragon that is attacking, that is moved by the player. Mm-hmm. And now I really, I should wait up here, the slides load. Sorry for the delay, a couple of seconds. And then I will also talk a bit about the loop. So, okay. The data for this demo is at the same place as before. Dragon was designed in Spine. It's a two-dimensional, it's a package for creating two-dimensional animations using bones, skeletal animations. What I wanted to emphasize is that we support it, and we support it up perfectly, that's good. To load the background, like I mentioned, we created a two-dimensional scene manager. That's one thing that we want to do. Actually, we use a two-dimensional scene manager created for us by a component called TechCast2D control. I must click on it. Okay, so what we do have is we have a TechCast2D control. This is the class. And we said, okay. And we want to use a background, creating a 2D scene. We want to load it from a normal 3D file that actually contains a background, I will show it shortly. And we want to add this background or scene manager. And there's nothing new here except these lines, and they say exactly to set the default camera such that it sees 721 units vertical. Why? Because my background, my two-dimensional background, but actually it's X3D, actually it's just a three-dimensional background that simply makes most sense when visible on this 2D. Okay, so this is the file that defines our background. It's just a shape, rectangular shape that uses a simple texture. Now, I didn't have to do it like this, I'm going through X3D. I could also just use a method in my engine saying render image. There are two options, so you can just set an XVD file to define your background, or you can just draw an image using Logic Pascal. So both of these things were quite good. What I wanted to show more is that you can, when you want to load a dragon, like something moving on a scene, you do the same thing. Basically, you create a 2D scene, two-dimensional scene, you load it from a JSON file, this is a format exported, that's fine for you. You say to turn on the events processing, I mean, it's after it's importing in model, it's an XVD singer, so you just use XVD events to run an animation, and you write animation, adding it to a scene manager, and that's it. Here I just mentioned that the viewport is actually kind of taken care of for you. I'll probably skip it very fast, but the idea here is that once you have a model, you can of course move and scale it. It's kind of obvious that you can skip it. And of course you can capture the mouse events, and then once you have a position where you should go, you know you can move your object as you want. So if you give me, just do it very fast. And I blink a code to you just to show that it's really short. It's not much obsessive. Here we set up our scene, background, dragon. Here we set, the same thing. Here we capture mouse events. And here, every frame, we wonder, okay, do we have some target where we want to move? Yeah, okay, then let's move. Let's move in X axis, let's move in Y axis. And also let's make a little trick to flip the direction where the dragon is looking. Obvious in a second. Yes. Is it okay if I prolong for 4 minutes longer? Just 4 minutes, really. It's usually really fast. I wasn't lying when I said that Object Pascal is usually has a very fast compiler. Yeah, but in this case, my computer is very slow, so I'm blaming the computer. If you're interested about the Pascal, I should also add here that we use a normal debugger and a normal profiler, because the compiled code is compatible for things like gproc and debugging. And GDB, so you know, if you know basically the tools, the Unix tools, to debug and to profile code, then it's all available here. Yeah. It's not like an exotic language, it's integrated with the normal debugging and profiling tools. As a side note, and that's, I'm clicking, coordinates are changing, dragon is moving, animation is playing all the time in a loop, so it's very not coordinated with the moving in any way. And the thing that why the dragon is rotating left and right, it's because of these lines. Yeah. You're scaling, when it looks to the left, you're just scaling the x-axis here and there. Yeah, it's negative or not negative, or positive, depending on which direction we go. This is a trick that, you know, in normal three-dimensional graphics, especially with lighting, negative scale is kind of a bad thing. A lot of artifacts, but in this case there's no lighting, it's a two-dimensional object, so this scale is something very simple to use in the box. Conclusion very short. So as you saw, you can use have a kind of a ready higher level management of player, items, inventory, creatures, world, actually just the basic thing, but I hope that it looks like okay. Can configure a lot of things there, and they are all extensible. I mean, it's just they are just classes. You can override things in Object Pascal or in XML. I try this to be, you know, a good thing for game designers, for level designers to use. You can directly use, you know, 2D and 3D objects like a kind of that lower level, and you can just rotate and scale them, you know, in your own code. You can use the XVD scene graph. I didn't show it too much after all, but. You can guess that any node you have in XVD is reflected, and you can modify any of its properties. It's just working. Just a short note that you have an Android support and iOS support too. The basic difference when using it is that you can't use the control class that you have used in these examples. You have to use kind of a window class, because if on Android, well, the engine must have to take care of the full rendering. It must render to the full window. Actually, it's possible to tweak it for custom applications, but by default, it's easiest when the engine just takes the full Android screen and renders to it 100%. And we have a build tool that basically takes care of packaging, creating from your source code, from the Pascal file. You just provided the Pascal file, and in the response, it provides you a ready Android APK, Android package file that you can upload to your phone or to your to Google Play, it just works. Okay, so this is an example Pascal code of our two-dimensional game. It's really nothing fancy here. And you things do declare to an XML like this, as for the customer reminders. When you point it to the Pascal sources, and you say, okay, spin orientation and so on, and it's you run our build tool from command line and it creates for you an Android package. So this kind of works. And I also wanted to mention that we can integrate with, I mentioned before that we can integrate easily with any native libraries because it's a native code on Linux, Windows and so on. And on Android you can of course integrate easily with any Java libraries because there's a something called JNI which allows us to integrate well, and Java API, these are some example APIs that we have actually integrated with, and it was kind of smooth and short and easy. So it's easy. Okay, and thank you very much. I'm sure it was okay and understandable. If you have any questions? Okay, I want to emphasize that all the examples and so on are on the internet, and the slides will be shortly on the internet too, so you know, if you want, you can follow all this at home. Too. Interesting. Questions? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
I have a short one. A couple of our students built a game in X3D using JavaScript to code the entire logic. Is it possible to just import that to the Castle engine and it will work, or do I have to manually adapt to make the JavaScript work together with the
Basically, it should work, but we did not implement JavaScript integration yet. So it kind of, it's not the design idea. We have implemented our own scripting language inside the XVD, but JavaScript not yet. But that's actually something that is very soon coming. There's a project called Besson that we want to integrate. I hope this summer will be definitely something that's coming. So this is actually not a design thing about the engine, it's just a feature lock. We didn't implement JavaScript yet. But when you do it, it will work, you don't even have to, you know, compile your own program, you can just use our even GPC and run it, and it should just work. So, bad thing and good thing. Yeah, it's not a design issue, it's just a lack of implementation.
Welcome back to the tutorial session. Now with Michael Ken from the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute, and he's going to talk about the geospatial component and posting, I think, on oceanographic data. So,
sure.
Hopefully, we'll be able to map the ocean after this.
Okay, good. Well, welcome. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so as you know, I've been passing around a memory stick with a VirtualBox appliance, and there's installers for VirtualBox and then in the appliance, and it's a full setup of the application, the Stokes application, that hopefully at the end of the tutorial we'll have time to play around with some examples, actually interact with the geospatial database, and present some data using X3D and X3DOM. But before that, I'm going to go through a set of slides to introduce the geospatial component, and especially in relation to how we use it for oceanographic data. So let's start with that. Just to reiterate, I was encouraged to have this tutorial be more hands-on than in the past Web3D tutorials. That's why we have the VirtualBox appliance going around. Where's the memory stick right now? Yeah. So if you can just copy the files from it, the VirtualBox installer, if you need it for your computer, and the .ova file, 1.6 gigabyte. So I wanted to just start first with a video that we have on YouTube, which I'm going to not play off the internet. I have a local copy here. It gives a nice 3-minute introduction to Stokes, to a general audience. So let me make sure the volume is cranked up.
Marine organisms in the upper ocean are responsible for producing half of all the oxygen we breathe. But measuring and understanding the processes that influence life in the upper ocean is challenging. Researchers at the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute have been making steady progress on this problem. Dr. Francisco Chavez, a biological oceanographer, studies these processes and works with engineers on developing new methods for measuring and understanding the upper ocean.
We conceptually came up with the need for a system that would allow us to easily look through the data from many of these platforms that were generating a lot of data. We use traditional ships. We use AUVs of different forms. We use gliders of different forms and types. We use drifters.
Huge reams of data collected must be organized and made useful. Engineers at the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute have developed a software package that helps scientists manage, visualize, and analyze the data collected. The Spatial Temporal Oceanographic Query System, or STOCS, is a free and open source software package that provides web-based visualization of data collected by all of these platforms.
The database design allows us to store each single measurement and relate it to every other piece of information about the data. And it's that database design that allows applications to retrieve whatever is needed to present it for visualization or analysis. The free software allows us to tie into a community of software developers that provides an excellent resource for solving problems. It also allows us to build a system that we can freely share with the world.
We use STOCS for several of our projects. Canon is one of them, and the Monterey Bay Time Series is another. It is completely different from anything else that we have developed here in Ibarri. It allows us to merge a wide variety of data from many different platforms and look at them together.
Things like the Oculus Rift are real fun to play with as it allows a very immersive experience and a very large and complex data set. But what we really are moving towards is an ability to do deeper analysis of the data and then tie that in with these advanced visualization capabilities.
This is Danelle Klein at the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute.
Okay, well that hopefully gives a kind of a general audience introduction to why we did this, how this fits in, but maybe what should underscore for this audience is just how the 3D stuff just fits naturally in with the web application, and you know, and we found that the audiences are really enthralled with the immersive visualization. The Oculus Rift, to be honest, we don't really use it, but it's like good PR. So if you have an opportunity to do an Oculus Rift, you'll get good PR. Not sure what it really adds to getting insight into the data, but it's fun. Okay, so that's that video. The memory stick is going around. Where's the memory stick now? Okay, everybody who wants to get it and has a copy, okay, good. And there is in the video, it referenced the site that was on Google Code, but everything's moved over to GitHub now. And there's a branch on GitHub where there's instructions to installing this using Vagrant. And that Vagrant's actually a preferred way to go because you can start with just a bare operating system, and you install all the open source software from the repositories or build it from source. And the Vagrant build does that for you automatically. In fact, that's how I created the appliance that's on the memory stick. It took a couple hours or so to install everything, and I exported it as an appliance. And that's a really new feature, pretty cool stuff to be able to distribute software that way. Okay, so the tutorial outline introduced the general introduction to oceanographic data, how it's different, and why we're using X3D geospatial for that. I'm going to go into quite a bit of detail on the geospatial component, each node specifically, and then describe how the browser geospatial database flow works using AJAX requests and request response. And at the end, and I should finish this before the paper session starts, we'll start on the exercises. And by that time, you should all be able to log in and start your server that's on the memory stick. Okay, so oceanographic data. Our data from the ocean we collect You saw pictures of the robots, and the reason we built those robots is we're trying to study and understand the time-varying three-dimensional structure of the ocean. And the ocean is full of life, plankton, and zooplankton and ethoplankton, and the temporal scales of variability go from seconds to months and centuries for understanding climate change and how the biology affects that. We need to measure scales, spatial and temporal scales, at a very large dynamic range. The data sets produced from these investigations are now huge. We'll have campaigns that last 3 or 4 weeks and produce over 30 million measurements from dozens of different platforms. So it's a data management nightmare, if you will, for that. We long ago realized that we need to organize the data inside databases, and that's why we take Postgres and PostGIS geospatial databases for that. And X3D offers a general solution for looking at the data and maintaining this 3D structure, because there's a true mapping of 3D geospatial coordinates to X3D's Cartesian XYZ coordinates. So at Ambari, we do use a lot of GIS tools, ArcGIS, SHOP, but that tends to flatten things, and when we're concerned about the third dimension as much as we are in the ocean, we prefer to stay in fully 3D the whole time. X3D's general, we're able to exaggerate the vertical coordinate to tease out the interactions that's happening in the upper thin layer of the ocean where all the biology happens near the sunlight. And we can achieve centimeter scale accuracies in our positioning using the, for instance, the geo-origin concept. With X3DOM, we have support for modern web frameworks that works on all platforms now, tablets, smartphones, browsers. And with X3D, we get runtime interaction. We can have events and routes and create animations and things that are not available in other globe viewer solutions. So another, just to champion the case for geospatial components and ISO specification, there's multiple implementations. X3DOM is just the most recent incarnation. There's an active working group in the Web3D consortium where discussions take place to advance the specification, to share use cases. We invite everybody here to join that working group and help make this help you too. And there's lots of volunteers to help that happen. So introduction to geospatial components supports multiple coordinate systems. Geographic coordinate system, we're all familiar with latitude, longitude, elevation, or depth. The geocentric Cartesian coordinate system, Earth-centered, XYZ. In some communities, in the geospatial component, the abbreviation for that is GC or GCC, geocentric. Some communities call that ECEF. You see that the GMT toolbox, which is an open source toolbox for dealing with geospatial data, uses that term Earth-centered, Earth-fixed. It's the exact same coordinate system. There's a local X3D coordinate system, which is what is used in the browser. And that, through various settings and using the geospatial node, it may be offset. Through a geo-origin, it may be rotated. And the geospatial component handles all of the conversions between these three coordinate systems behind the scenes in such a way that you don't really need to be aware of it unless you're doing something special. There's a the asterisk at the bottom. There's other spatial reference systems that the geosystem attributes supports. For instance, UTM is supported, Universal Transmission Mercator. We have experimental edition of the Webb Mercator projection, which is used for slippy maps. But there's support if you want to write a geoid reference system or some other obscure datum or state plane datum. It has the facility to do that if someone needs it. So the architecture is really robust to be able to handle all the different spatial reference systems. I showed this slide during the paper presentation this morning, just a review of the XYZ Cartesian Earth-centered coordinate system and lambda and phi for the latitude and longitude. So the geospatial component makes it easy to use geo and X3D. You can provide your geo content in familiar latitude, longitude, elevation coordinates. The X3D browser works in XYZ. It deals with numerical precision issues. And and we'll adjust the Y up vector so that the fly navigation mode will work properly. In a nutshell, it handles all the transformations and precision calculations to work with geographic data. So there's the promoting geospatial component. The node set for geospatial is, there's about 11 nodes in the specification. The ones that are in bold are supported in X3DOM now. The ones that are bold italic are experimental X3DOM. There's three nodes that aren't really supported in X3DOM. The GeoLED, GeoProximity Sensor, and GeoTouch Sensor are not supported yet. But I'll go through each of the nodes in detail now. So any questions so far?
I have a general question about X3DOM. Is it easily possible to subclass these nodes or to work on these nodes or to change the nodes without changing X3DOM?
Yes. Okay. So the question is, can you extend it?
Yeah.
Can you subclass a node or add a new node? It is. In fact, that's how these experimental nodes were developed, just following the same patterns and understanding how the X3DOM works. Because these nodes actually inherit from X3D from more abstract nodes in the scene graph hierarchy. I don't know if I'm using the right terminology, the object code hierarchy for X3D. Like GeoTransform is a grouping node, and GeoCoordinate inherits from coordinate node or something else that maybe.
Well, if I'm missing a functionality, is it easy to add it to the node directly?
You need to know JavaScript pretty well.
Yeah, sure.
And my co-author on the paper this morning is that person who knows it really well. And he spent a lot of time understanding X3DOM. So, and the mail list is a great place to engage that kind of discussion. Okay, so we'll dive through each node in detail here. Okay, so there is simplicity used. You can build geometry from geocoordinate nodes just like coordinate nodes in X3D. Geocoordinates may be specified using familiar latitude, longitude, and depth numbers. And there's a naming similarity. Nodes like geo elevation grid work just like elevation grid, except you use latitude, longitude, and depth for the data. So each node in detail, these are the building blocks of awesomeness. Geocoordinate purpose, you specify a list of geographic coordinates. Can use geocoordinate anywhere in X3D. Coordinate can go like a point set, index face set, index line set, etc. And you can build models in terms of latitude, longitude, depth. For instance, a road line segment or a GPS track. You can build an index face set of a cloud using geocoordinates. An example of what the X3D would look like. Geocoordinates inside an index line set inside a shape. Here's an image from our old application. It was actually built in geothermal. These are the Hawaiian island chains here, and this is a GPS track of our ship. It's the big white ship in the video that went to Hawaii a few years ago. And you can see that the point attributes is just latitude, longitude, depth, comma, latitude, longitude, depth. Pretty simple. A geo-elevation grid, you can define a height field using geographic coordinates. Use it anywhere that an elevation grid can go. The geometry field of a shape node, you can create terrain models for local or large areas. And it automatically introduces the correct Earth curvature. So if you specify geo-elevation grid for local Earth, you'll get an ellipsoid. Just a small area, it'll have actually a curvature. Something the size of the state of California, it's really easy to see the curvature. Here's an example here. It's from Baja, California up to Canada border, and you can see the curvature here. This is what it looks like inside X3D. The geolocation, this is to georeference just a plain vanilla X3D model. It's a grouping node that affects the location of the children. It also sets the orientation so that plus y is up and minus z is north. place a non-georeferenced model at its correct location and orientation, or you can place a viewpoint inside a geolocation. There's all kinds of possibilities here. All of the translations and rotations are handled by the geo code underneath. Here's an example from the original author of GeoVermal, Martin Reddy, worked at Stanford Research Institute. Here's models of his building on top of an elevation, a satellite image of the data. So, pretty easy to specify latitude, longitude, elevation, and URL to the plain vanilla X3D. GeoLOD provides level of detail to support management of multi-resolution terrains. It's a grouping node. It was originally developed in the context of Cosmo Player, which did not do caching well for LODs. Yes?
I have a quick question. You go to the previous slide for a second. The building model there, where is the center of the coordinate system for the building itself? Is it in the center of the building somewhere, or?
It's the origin of the plain vanilla model.
Okay.
So that's where you need to point, that's where the geo-coordinates needs to be.
Okay.
It needs to be the origin, the zero point in your model.
The zero point, it has to be aligned, otherwise
right.
The building will be shaped.
Exactly.
Okay.
And I have another question for that. Imagine that you have a model with a bridge from USA to Europe, for example. Would curvature apply to this model too, or is it just staked on the zero point and then it's
That would probably fly off into space because the geolocation would not take into account large gigantic models and apply the curvature. For that kind of application, you want to build it out of geocoordinate nodes.
Mm-hmm.
So GeoLOD, it's not implemented in X3DEM. The main reason for that is that the mesh and SRC format is proving more efficient for progressive loading large mesh data.
Mm.
So, but it still exists in the spec. And it, I was saying before that the Cosmo Player did not do caching of LOD, the regular X3D LOD node well, so that we had to be able to unload tiles before loading the next one in if you're navigating it down. The other problem with LOD, which has been published in papers, is that it's a sequential loading thing. So if you want to go do a space-to-face visualization, it has to load every intermediate tile, great-grandfather, grandfather, all the way down before loading the final one. So it does not perform well. Here's an example of what it looked like. You'd have the four child nodes here, and the coarse resolution on top, progressively higher resolution data. GeoMetadata is just a way to attach information to any geo node. This is to support rich metadata that might be a Dublin Core style metadata to describe where it came from. It's similar to a world info node. And then I've talked in the paper presentation quite a bit about the geo origin. It's used to offset the geocentric coordinates to increase floating point precision. You can use a geo origin node. In an X3D, in some of the constraints, you can only have one geo origin in a scene. And a little bit of history and why in the X3D version 3.3 specification it says deprecated is because if you build content with a geo origin, that content cannot be combined with another content because everything will be offset. So, There was some experimentation in the original XJ3D toolkit to do dynamic geo origin updating inside a scene. And the reason that a browser would want to do that is to allow mashups of data. If I build my content, someone else builds an atmospheric model content, and we can do that without a geo origin, and we can all mash up the same data. So you really only want to add a geo origin if you really need it, because as soon as you do that, then your content cannot be combined with other content. Here's an example of a scene, I think appropriate for where we are now, with some columns, some more Greek columns. Without a geo origin, there's jitter in the object and the location of these items. But if you add a geo origin in your scene, then everything lines up properly because the round off precision goes away.
So is this deprecated? Is there an alternative?
Is there an alternative?
Yeah, if this functionality is deprecated, is there another way to offset origins?
Yeah, it can be done in the browser, and it was actually implemented in XJ3D. What's it called? I forget the name now. It was the Java token. The browser knows the viewpoint of the avatar, and it could, and if the origin it was far away from that, it could then bring the origin closer, and then behind the scenes automatically subtract a local origin relative to the viewpoint, and then update all the geometry before it goes to the rendering pipeline. Mm-hmm. And that was actually implemented and done. And then if the moves on the other side of the globe, then there'd be a little pause as the geometry is all recalculated. So that
I understood that the geo origin itself is duplicated.
Is that to be duplicated?
Deprecated.
Deprecated.
Deprecated. So you are not supposed to use it anymore.
It's in version 3.3, but there's a request into the X3D working group to de-deprecate it. Because further testing, we know that it's still needed. But the spec language will say it's advised not to use it unless you really need it.
Okay. But there's no alternative.
Right. Well, the alternative is to implement the same functionality in a browser. But that's expecting a lot of X3DOM, or another person wants to implement X3D. Mm-hmm. It's actually easier to support the geo origin node than to implement an automatic geo origin calculation in your browser code. Mm-hmm. We already talked about some of the scene may only contain one geo origin, content with different geo origins can't be combined. Advice is to avoid geo origin, prevents mashing up content. Some cases it's useful. Some graphic pipelines require it for high precision scenes. You can use it to rotate Y up to support different navigation modes. And the description of just how it works, the geo origin is subtracted, rotate Y up is requested, blah, blah. Geoposition interpolator, newly implemented in X3DOM, you can animate objects with geographic coordinate system. You can use it anywhere a position interpolator can go. You can use it to animate a viewpoint, animate vehicles on a GPS track, or keyframe locations. Here's a screenshot of how it's used in an application where one of our remotely operated vehicles goes down to the bottom and traverses around. It was routed to a little slider here that could slide up and down, and it would move the remotely operated vehicle model. Here also you can see maybe the effect of the geo LED working. Here's some high resolution terrain tiles, and then the coarse resolution ones with tearing in between. So that's this is the old 10-year-old Wormhole application that used to work in CosmoPlayer. Geo proximity sensor used to record geographic location of viewer's position. This is not supported in X3DOM. I think there's a fundamental reason is that proximity sensors maybe have limited support in X3DOM. I'm not sure. But the way it's used is you could route the actual latitude, longitude, position back and display it as in a text node inside your scene. And then a touch sensor, I think this is not supported in X3DOM because the touch sensor support is expected to be done using the DOM events, regular JavaScript DOM events. And if you click on a point in the scene, you can actually get the geographic location back. And this is done here too. If you click somewhere on the terrain, it would report the latitude, longitude, and depth. Kind of a useful feature. GeoTransform, another kind of difficult thing to wrap your head around, but the purpose is to translate and rotate geo-coordinate geometry relative to the ellipsoidal tangent plane. So the use case for that we had in our application here is a remotely operated vehicle backtrack that intersects our representation of the seafloor. And there's a little slider here that you can move up and down. And if the geocoordinate geometry is wrapped in a geotransform, then the up vector is properly transformed and calculated so that the route to the Y up works properly, and you can slide the whole vehicle track up and down. So this is just part of the tools that handle the automatic transformation between geographic, geocentric, and local X3D coordinate systems. Okay, grouping node. We're experimenting now in the discussions on the geospatial working group list is that the experimental node that was on the list, GeoOrigin Transform, we might be able to combine those. And another little nice little interesting side effect with a directive on geotransform, you could actually wrap a whole set of geometry inside a single geotransform and tell it to apply a single geoorigin to all the nodes underneath. And that's just another way to apply geoorigin, which may be more efficient in repeating geoorigin in each geonode. So okay, did I go forward? Geotransform, I already talked about that, didn't I? Okay, now here's an example, sliding the vehicle track up and down. Geo viewpoint makes it easy to specify a viewpoint using geographic coordinates. You can use it anywhere a regular viewpoint node can go, and it properly orients the relative up vector to that location. It also has the attribute to control the navigation speed and non-examined modes. We'll picture what it would look like. You can pick an elevation and an angle to look down, give you the orientation, set the navigation type, so forth. And then just easily provide the latitude, longitude, elevation points. This is the first of the experimental nodes, the Geo web map, and it's a way to bring in slippy map image as a texture to a 3D scene. And you can take advantage of the existing 2D mapping infrastructure that's available on the internet now and bring all that interesting data into X3D, like OpenStreetMap layers can be brought straight into the X3D scene. And the nice thing about this is that you could build your own standalone systems on private networks. There are companies that will sell you solutions for web mapping tools, but if you want to, a lot of them require connection to the internet, and we want to put them on our ships at sea, and that won't work, so we want to be able to have complete control over our data. And maybe serve up our own terrain tile sets via OpenStreetMap type mechanism, and we could build that and own all of it. As an example of what it looks like, there's a lot of simplicity here. Just example, the Geo Web Map. There's an attribute called SRC that you specify the ID for the div that represents the open layers map div, and then the new geosystem, the code for Web Mercator, and that's about as simple as it looks. There's a lot of guts behind that. There's some things I'm leaving out with the dot dot dots, but the very first top div represents the two-dimensional open layers map, and then this div inside the same HTML5 scene graph is the X3DOM output, and then these two views are connected. You change one, the other one updates. You change the other one updates. So this is trying to achieve our vision for the geospatial to make it real easy to use geospatial data, and I think this is a good example of that. GeoOrigin Transform, another experimental node, and this is to apply GeoOrigin offset rotation information to non-geospatial X3D geometry. And this is for the use case of building, say, a terrain map from LiDAR data, or how we map the C4 from sonar data. I can create a mesh using Earth-centered Earth-fixed coordinates, completely Cartesian, and then build a X3DOM SRC, shape resource container, file of those data, and they're not in a geosystem coordinate, unless you consider a geocentric one, but I'd have other data that is using a geo-origin, and I need to apply that same geo-origin to that geocentric data that composes that mesh, so this is a way to do that.
A quick question on this, use elevation maps, what is the resolution? I mean, can you apply on a city model to get elevation of the building and build a city model out of it?
I think the answer is yes.
Yeah. Okay. It's like you can get a generic polygonal model that covers the whole city, or you could go to the individual building level.
Here's an example of we have, this is 1 meter resolution terrain of Monterey Submarine Canyon, and this is where I needed to use the geo origin transform to subtract an offset at location near the center here. So this is a case where we're resolving basically centimeter scale activity. This records actually an instrument that got transmitted down the submarine canyon in a submarine landslide.
How big is that in reality? How big is that cylinder there? The height?
This is, if you can see here where this purple line here is, this is the width of the submarine canyon flow. Oh. That's probably 100 meters across.
Okay.
And that gives you scale.
But the accuracy, I mean, if I, let's say I would collect data for a city, can I get can I pick a model of the building which is 10 meters high that would be kind of popping out from the rest of this terrain?
So questions about precision and the accuracy?
Trying to see if I can get some kind of, from this data I can generate a city model based with decent accuracy. I mean, Google, for example, they speak, you know, with a kind of basic point cloud and try to generate some kind of elevation for the buildings and then map textures on top to give a good enough sense
I've seen that too in Google Earth. If you put place data real close together and you zoom in, there's like jitter and offsets.
Yes, you can get. But you can get a pretty good, it's almost like a polygonal model of a city with textures that they get from the street view. Mm-hmm. It's not the street view itself, the street view is just basically a canyon with textures on left and right. But they actually generate a kind of polygonal model.
Yeah.
And mostly in the other room.
Okay.
It's kind of thinking. So you can get something similar with what they have from this?
I don't see any reason why you couldn't build that.
And
this.
I'm just saying that buildings in a city would probably require higher resolution.
Right.
Meter, 1 meter. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure if that data can be gathered from satellite.
Right. So we have visions, we have systems now that can map to sea floor at centimeter scale, photography and bathymetry. And we fully expect to be able to use this technology for that. The key is the geo origin. Place a geo-origin close to that, mm-hmm. and then all the numbers work properly through the GPU pipeline.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, how am I doing on time here? Oh, pretty good. Okay, so that's the introduction to the quick tour through all the geospatial component nodes. Any other questions about that? Yes.
Yeah, If I'm not mistaken, all the rendering is done in the geocentric coordinate system, right?
Why?
No, that's right. It's,
that's right.
Yeah.
Right.
So is there any way to render in a local coordinate system if we don't want to have projection in our pipeline?
So the question, is there a way to render in the local coordinate system?
Yeah.
So just to be clear, this, the local coordinate system is the same as the X3D coordinate system. Is that?
I'm talking about, well, imagine you're in a city with using EPSG like 3946, something like that.
Okay.
And you want to render in this coordinate system.
Oh, I see. So, if you have data in a different data in EPSG code, and it's not, so that's to map that into the geospatial component that corresponds to what we call geosystem. So the geosystem support in X3DOM now is WGS84, which is EPSG 4326, and also UTM. So you would have to transform your data to those, one of those geosystem coordinates to use it in X3D geospatial. There was some discussion of actually using the PROJ4 library, which supports all the EPSG code transformations, and then supporting all of the different spatial reference models that the EPSG specifies. But X3DOM needs to be a standalone library, there was a requirement to not depend on any external libraries.
So I think the question was not so much about transformation of data, but about the rendered representation. For example, if you render it in UTM, you would expect to have a flat surface. And if it's possible to use, say, UTM or a flat surface, not a curved.
That's not how X3D geospatial works. Everything is geocentric.
Okay.
Yep. So there's no projection. Everything is 3D. It maintains the 3D nature of the data. Did that answer?
Yes.
Okay. Anything else about the geospatial component? Notes. Okay, so about how the Stokes applications work. And starting at the browser and connecting to a database and the data flow for that. And the basic steps are the browser will make an HTTP request. This would be an AJAX request. And the server software receives that. Then translates that into structured query language to get the data from the database. And the server responds with an XML HTTP response, XHR, but it's not XML, it's JSON. So it returns it as a JSON structure, and then JavaScript on the client then unpacks that JSON structure, pulls the data out, and updates elements in the DOM to update fields in the X3D node set. For instance, like the points in a line set would be updated with data from the database. And then the X3D scene updates with that selected data. So that's the basic sequence of an AJAX request response. And what that looks like in the code that you can look at in the Stokes application is the HTML5 with X3D looks just like HTML5. It's an X3D element, a scene element. The way Stokes works is there's a shape node with an ID, and this is the stands for measure parameter X3D track, and there's a viewpoint, and then an inline node for the terrain.
So it's just this little bit of X3D that will show a terrain model and then data from one of our robots that's been collected, displayed in relation to that terrain. So that's the scene graph DOM. The XHR response containing the JSON will come back after the database has been queried, and we get the data back for whatever parameter that has been measured, and we get a list of data, some colors, some indexes, and some latitude, longitude points. And this is what's fed in to the child of that shape node, which is going to be an index line set, or it could be an index point set, to actually populate that with real data so that it gets displayed in the scene. And then the jQuery code to do that, here's that same element, MP measure parameter X3D track. It just updates that HTML with an index line set that unpacks that JSON structure with the colors and the points and the indexes for that. So that's just the basic setup and operation for doing AJAX updates to an X3D scene graph based on data in the database.
Okay. I have a question. Isn't there a lot of parsing going on? Because you get the data as JSON, and here you have lists of points, and then you make from these lists strings, make these HTML string, and then you update the node, and then X3DOM has to parse it again.
It does.
So
yes.
Okay. There another. Couldn't you, if these elements already exist, could you set the color directly? Right, that attribute color to a list of points, or do you have to go over the HTML string?
I think there's probably more than one way to do this. Mm-hmm. There were things that did not update automatically with new data, and I think at one time, and I started with version 1.5 of X3DOM,
yeah.
And there's some things that didn't have listeners on the right fields. So it depends whether the listener is there or not.
And the other replace.
Right. Right. And I'm not going to put myself out there as an expert JavaScript programmer. I'm sure there's a lot of inefficiencies here and so forth. And as part of my insidious plan to give you all the server, and you can look at it and give me advice. Okay, now it's time for exercises, and the paper session starts in 15 minutes, right?
That's right, yeah.
Okay.
So if you want to participate in the paper session, you're going to use this door for the first 5 minutes after the session starts, and then you'll have to go around once it's part of the project. Okay, so maybe we'll have to do the transition now. If you want to switch back to the exercise, you can do that, but you have to go around.
So I'm done talking at you. What I'll do now is walk around, and if you've got the VirtualBox appliance up, you can launch the server, the part in red, so if you have to type into a terminal session, and then you should be able to see an image on your computer here. And I'll walk around and make sure everybody can get that far.